Homes. So eliminate steam with a shower dome shower top. With shower dome, you get a warmer, drier bathroom and a lifetime guarantee. That'll give you the warm fuzzies. Showerdome.co.nz.
It's time to cut and run. This time I'm really done.
Is your team driving today? Restricted drivers are more at risk of crashing when driving with friends. There's a reason for the restrictions. Home by 10 p.m. No passengers.
Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices. TradeDepot.co.nz. Everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? Paydayadvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, paydayadvance.co.nz.
Battery Town, Battery Town. If your battery is letting you down.
Is your vehicle sounding slower to start? Get it tested at your local Battery Town workshop now. For all car, truck, motorcycle or motorhome batteries before you get stuck. With over 90 stores nationwide, there's one near you. Call 0800 566 667.
There's only one place to go and that's Battery Town.
Man needs meat. You office workers need meat. It gives you strength to laugh at your boss's inappropriate jokes. The energy for idle chit-chat at the coffee machine. And you know you can't spell meetings without meat, right? Get some Jack Link's beef jerky into your drawers. And I mean the ones under your desk. You don't need HR asking awkward questions again, do you? Jack Link's. Feed your wild side.
Three quotes instantly sent, then accepted. 2 months of cash flow correctly projected. One finished tax return. Your accountant's a hero.
Woo-hoo!
Know your numbers. Get started with Xero. Get 50% off Xero for 3 months at Xero.com. Terms apply.
And now, live from the Today FM News Centre in central Auckland.
And with bureaus around the country and around the world.
It's time for Tova on Today FM.
Now that you're out of my life, I'm so much better. You thought that I'd be weak without you, but I'm stronger. You thought that I'd be broke without you, but I'm richer. You thought that I'd be sad without you, I left harder. Thought I wouldn't grow without you, now I'm wiser.
Kia ora, good morning Aotearoa, you're listening to Today FM, I'm Tova O'Brien, welcome to this chilly Thursday, isn't it? I mean, I know I've become a bit of a snowflake since I moved to Auckland a year ago, but brr, how is it where you are in, around the country? 3920, remember you can get in touch on anything over the course of the program. The Stuart Nash saga continues with an investigation now into all his communications with cash donors after it was revealed that he leaked confidential cabinet information to two of them who happen to have vested interests as well. We're going to speak to former New Zealand First MP Shane Jones, also to political editor Joe Moyer about where to from here. And I'm particularly interested in what I was just talking with Rach about, that colluding, by the looks of it, between Stuart Nash's office and the Prime Minister's office back in 2021 to keep that smoking gun email out of the public domain. Appalling. In my book, it is 20 years since Waikato mum Sarah Neath was last seen alive. The family is making one last desperate bid for answers. We're speaking to a private investigator, Bruce Curry, who has been helping their search for the past 3 years, doing amazing work. I think more than 800 hours of pro bono work for that whānau to try and help get them closure. She is one of the best known conservative TV hosts in the United States, a Fox News poster girl who rose to prominence during the Trump era. We have Tommy Lehren on the show with us. I'm really excited. She's got more social media followers across the various platforms than we have people in New Zealand. We're going to talk to her about gun laws. She is a big proponent of the First Amendment, the right to bear arms, but I have kind of different views about this, particularly after this raft of mass shootings in the United States and this most recent one at another school. So we'll have a bit of a debate around gun law reform in the US. Also, should New Zealand follow the lead on some Australian states and look into banning Nazi salutes and swastikas? Queensland is the latest to jump on board and is moving to ban those symbols of hate. West Auckland residents are fighting for more support after the recent storm. We are talking to the Welshman who went viral after completing his citizenship ceremony for New Zealand in Te Reo Māori. He has been blown away by the online response. We have all the details of what could be the celebrity court trial of the year. I lost half a day skiing. Gwyneth Paltrow, she has become a meme. We'll find that clip for you as well, Jeremy, if you could put that on your to-do list because it's a goodie. Also, your chance to win with Tova's $1,000 question. Our countdown continues as well for Today FM's greatest Kiwi of all time, number 81. We're revealing just after 8.30. Who did Rachel Smalley have just then? Oh, Peter Gordon. Brilliant. Great shout. So we'll work through some of the ones that we've announced to date. Keep your guesses coming in and your votes coming in as well. todayfm.co.nz. Let me know who you think the greatest Kiwi of all time should be. 3920. We have a great show for you this morning. Let us slay today.
Today FM. Breaking overnight.
Metro Nashville's police chief says that authorities have met with the Covenant school shooter's parents and school officials but have yet to uncover any specific issues or problems in the attacker's past. The deadly rampage on Monday lasted about 14 minutes before the shooter was shot and killed by police. The assailant killed 3 9-year-olds. As well as a custodian, a substitute teacher, and the head of the school. Following the revelation that the shooter may have planned further attacks, both on their own family and at a shopping mall, the release of police body cam footage has seen two officers involved hailed as heroes.
31-year-old Michael Colazzo is a Marine Corps vet and a former firefighter who responded to the Christmas Day bombing in Nashville back in 2020.
And then there's 27-year-old Rex Engelbert. He received a commendation for precision policing just last week.
They could see it from the helicopter, constant gunfire on these officers, and you can hear the officers really take command, saying, go, 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 let's roll, real heroes. And a lot of people in Nashville are thanking them because they truly saved other lives.
To Europe now, and King Charles has begun a 3-day state visit to Germany, his first trip abroad since becoming the king. He had originally intended to also visit France, but those plans had to be postponed because of violent protests taking place against the French government's proposed pension reforms. Let's bring in our correspondent Trent Murray from Berlin. Now, Morena, Trent, a big occasion for both the UK and Germany, this. What's on the agenda?
Yeah, kia ora, Tova. Good morning. I mean, a really big occasion, I think, for both countries. In fact, we've just seen King Charles and the Queen Consort Camilla leave the hotel that they're staying at here at Brandenburg Gate to zip across town to the state banquet. That's one of the main formalities on the agenda here. We also know that they will be speaking tomorrow at the German Parliament, King, that is. And that is a real first. We've never had a British monarch address the German Parliament in the past. I think this is a really significant moment because obviously there's been so much disruption and turbulence in many ways in the relationship between the UK and Europe because of Brexit. I think what we're seeing here is the British government almost rolling the monarch out, if you will, to try and heal some of those wounds that may have been inflicted during that time. Exactly. So, look, a big occasion. And I think, you know, it's not lost on the Germans the importance of all of this. There is a lot of security, and I think they want to make sure that nothing goes wrong, given that French part of the trip had to be cancelled.
Awesome. Hey, Trent, thank you very much. All the best with your reporting on this momentous occasion.
You.
Take care. Trent Murray, our correspondent in Berlin there, racing off because he's chasing King Charles around Berlin by the sounds of things. It's 21 minutes to 7. Let's bring in Carly Flynn and John Day. Morena Kordua, how are we?
Morena.
This is exciting, isn't it, Carly? The second harbour bridge crossing. It looks like the government's leaked a bit of detail on this to the Herald.
There's been a lot of talk about this, of course, over the years. A lot of
cash spent as well.
Absolutely. And I suspect John Day's along with me in that we have to connect from the North Shore.
Yep, that's right.
And the reason we come to work at 4 a.m. is because of the harbour bridge being so clogged. But yeah, there is allegedly an announcement, according to the Herald this morning, exclusive story there, that Hipkins will be bringing forward the announcement announcement of one of five options, the likelihood of five options for the new crossing being completed in the 2020s.
What are you
not
guys?
Not the 2030s, oh, not the 2040s. Amazing. Well, look, there's been so much talk,
Tunnel?
Over. So, well, yes, but, you know, so much talk. You know, if you look at
you
the light rail,
them, do you?
You know, we're in an election year. It'll be great.
Like, we're going to have flying cars before
2029. Yeah, I mean, it would be wonderful because traffic in Auckland, forget March Madness, it's mad all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I feel for you guys, but I'm, you know, I love that that's why you come to work at 4 a.m. Not just because you work on a breakfast show, but also because you want to avoid that traffic and fair cop. JD, we've missed you the last couple of days while you've been furiously commentating all the cricket.
Yes, very busy.
Yes.
Fill us in as well on what's happening with Sevu Reece. This is massive news.
Yeah, it is big news. Sevu Reece has done his ACL in his knee, so year over for the Crusaders winger and the All Blacks winger. Of course, him and George Bridge were the two starting wingers at last year's World Cup. George Bridge is now playing overseas. Sevu Reece is injured. So now we're looking at the All Blacks wings and going, who is going to play there at the World Cup? And at the moment, Mark Talia for the Blues probably leaps off the page. He's been playing bloody well, but, you know, not really proven at test level. Only made his debut at the end of last year. Then you guys got guys like Caleb Clark, who's an absolute powerhouse for the Blues, but not that consistent. And Lester Fianganuku, he fits into that bracket as well. Will Jordan hasn't played this year, so already I've got my panic button. It's under my finger, and I am pressing it. I know we've only got 6 months until the World Cup's over, so decisions to be made out wide for the ABs.
Oh, that's such a way. That 6 months out from the moment, and you lose someone so critical, such an asset. Even I understand that that is very, very bad. Thank you very much, JD. Thanks so much, Carly. Let us know what you think. Does Auckland need a second harbour crossing? If you live in Auckland, you probably say yes. What do you want it to look like, though? The tunnel seem to be one of the more popular options. 3920, get in touch. If you're outside of Auckland, do you think we talk about the Harbour Bridge too much? I remember
all
thinking
the traffic,
that in Wellington.
All
and the
weather.
Traffic. You're just like, shut it off already. It's 18 minutes to 7, 3920 to get in touch.
Happening now.
Doubt Stuart Nash will be further punished following his dismissal after cabinet confidentiality breaches. Political commentator Grant Duncan says there are no rules enforceable by law to impose further reprimands. A bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells. Inter Islander and Bluebridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today. Forest and Bird is calling for natural wetlands to be doubled by 2050. The organisation claims only around 10% still exist. A deep low east of the north directs a strong southerly flow over central New Zealand. The southerly flow gradually eases today as a ridge builds over the country, and then a trough spreads from the west on Saturday.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Lots of people texting in, telling me what the weather's like in their area. In the mighty Manawatū, pretty cold. People are moving into pants from shorts and Kapiti Coast. It's warmer outside than inside. 3920, I want to hear what the weather's like where you are. Let's talk about the weather. And also, let's talk business with our senior business correspondent, Rebecca Stevenson. Super interesting, Rebecca, what's happening with tech giant Alibaba, an announcement about the company's future?
Yeah, huge news. The Chinese company is going to be broken up, and the markets really like the idea. Its shares rose 14% yesterday to close at US$98.40. So it says it's going to break itself up into six units, and five of those units will opt for initial public offerings. So investors will be able to get a slice of the Alibaba business. The really interesting thing, I think, is the timing. Alibaba's founder, Jack Ma, was just seen in China for the first time in about 3 years. He disappeared from the public eye after he criticized Chinese regulators. So this is seen as a good sign that he's been seen. And also there's this great news about Alibaba. You know, it is just a phenomenal business. It has been a really important pathway for New Zealand products to reach Chinese consumers. It has its online platforms, Tmall and Tmall Global, and they are just so popular. It is the biggest cross-border business to consumer channel in China. I had a look at some of their data points this week. 29,000 brands on its platforms, more than 5,800 categories of goods, and products from 87 countries, of course, including New Zealand products. Now, what is interesting as well is it says it will hold on to the Tmall part of the business. So that's good. So New Zealand businesses will still be able to deal directly with Alibaba.
Okay, that's the main thing.
It's saying
isn't it,
that it's. Russ? Yeah, exactly. And the new units, it say, will capture opportunities in their respective markets and industries and unlock the value of Alibaba Group's respective businesses.
Okay, so this is good news there for New Zealand exporters and manufacturers. Thank you so much, Rebecca, always. We'll chat again at about 20 to 9 this morning with our senior business correspondent, Rebecca Stevenson. Coming up next, we're looking into, so a whole bunch of states in Australia have banned swastikas and some have moved to ban Sig hailing as well after some of those Posy Parker rallies in Melbourne that attracted neo-Nazis. Should we be looking to ban the swastika and the Nazi salute here in New Zealand as well? We asked the Justice Minister. That's next.
Spend your nights with Polly.
Have you been scammed, Jeff?
Well, I'm being scammed just now. It was on TikTok, actually, and the name is Carrie Underwood. Now, Carrie Underwood is a country singer. I said, is that Carrie Underwood from... Yes, that's me. Me and Mike have split up, and I own 23 properties in a mansion in Oregon or something. But she said, I'm having trouble with my lawyers, and I need some money up front. Can you put $100,000 through to me?
You didn't do it, did you, Jeff?
No, I haven't done it.
I just can't imagine you being on TikTok. I tell you what, Carrie Underwood is not going to want $100,000 from a guy in New Zealand, as gorgeous and wonderful as he might be. Don't fall for that.
When you're talking to Carrie Underwood and you're thinking, wow, you feel really special, you know?
Yeah, Jeff. There are some bad people out there. There are some dirty, rotten scoundrels out there.
Am I able to sell some yandies to those buggers?
Yeah, well, there's a thought. Jeff, thank you so much for phoning.
Polly Gillespie.
Polly.
Tonight from 8.
On Today FM. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices. TradeDepot.co.nz. Everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door. TradeDepot.co.nz.
There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, call 0508 NetSafe 7 days a week. That's 0508 NetSafe. Or visit netsafe.org.nz.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? PaydayAdvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, PaydayAdvance.co.nz.
Bathroom moisture from shower steam. It's a problem in most homes. So eliminate steam with a shower dome shower top. With shower dome, you get a warmer, drier bathroom and a lifetime guarantee. That'll give you the warm fuzzies. Showerdome.co.nz.
It's time to cut and run. This time I'm really done.
Is your team driving today?
Restricted drivers are more at risk of crashing when driving with friends. There's a reason for the restrictions. Home by 10 p.m. No passengers.
Can you hear me, Dad? Are you somewhere out there? It's me, your son, Jimmy here. It's my birthday, Dad. I'm 8 today. So it's 7 years since you went away.
A good male role model can transform the life of a boy whose dad is not around. If you've been thinking about giving back, a couple of hours a week could make a world of difference in a young boy's life. Be somebody's big buddy. Change someone's life. For more, go to bigbuddy.org.nz.
Man needs meat. You office workers need meat. It gives you strength to laugh at your boss's inappropriate jokes. The energy for idle chit-chat at the coffee machine. And you know you can't spell meetings without meat, right? Get some Jack Link's beef jerky into your drawers. And I mean the ones under your desk. You don't need HR asking awkward questions again, do you? Jack Link's. Feed your wild side.
Destroying the incompetent every morning.
Fierce and fearless. There's only one Tova. With Generate. Switch to an award-winning KiwiSaver provider today.
On Today FM.
too busy mucking around on Instagram trying to figure out how to make a boomerang of Carol Hirschfeld and Tom Day holding up their cell phones and encouraging me along. You are listening to Today FM. Thanks to Generate KiwiSaver. Talk to the experts about maximising your KiwiSaver account. We're going to be talking a lot this morning about Stuart Nash. He flew into Napier last night. He's expected to decide his political future, whether he chooses to stay on at the next election or not, run again in his seat. National leader Christopher Luxon said yesterday afternoon that Nash needed to resign immediately and completely from the parliament. That would force a by-election. Nash reacted to those comments when he was approached by One News at the airport last night.
Chris is one of these guys who will smile to your face as he stabs you in the back. I've got no time for that sort of stuff. I don't think that the people of New Zealand have any appetite for spending $1 million on a by-election 6 months before an election. I know the people of Napier don't want a by-election. He just should concentrate on the issues that are important to the people of New Zealand as opposed to paying gotcha politics. So, you know, my answer to that is, Chris who?
That's, I mean, kind of fire there a little bit, right? But also, that guy has just lost so much credibility in my eyes. But interesting call from Stuart Nash there. Chris Luxon is someone who smiles in your face and stabs you in the back. Chris who? 10 minutes to seven.
Today FM.
New Zealand's listening.
South Africa's education system has been labelled as the worst in the world in a series of 5 reports released this week. Recommendations include the need for fresh leadership in government to help tackle corruption within the education system. For more on this, our correspondent Mark Routon joins us from Cape Town. Morena, Mark. What's been the response from the Department of Education and what can be done there in South Africa to improve things for kids?
Good morning. Yes, the Department of Education not very happy with this report and what it's saying. And it's actually interesting to quote the spokesperson for the department on a local station today, Wednesday, in South Africa, saying that, the same university professors who compile these reports are the ones who train our teachers. So if they point a finger, they must remember that they have 4 fingers pointing back. Last time I counted, I had 3. So it's an indication perhaps of part of the problem. But
my goodness,
more specifically, in the past 20 years, South Africa has scored poorly on a whole bunch of international benchmark tests. Grade 1 learners on one report found that after a year of school in grade 1, half of grade 1 learners do not yet know the full letters of the alphabet. By grade 4, 7 out of 10 learners still not able to read for meaning regardless of the language. So it's not just that they're perhaps learning in English, which is a second language for them. And South Africa has just done poorly in many other tests, maths proficiency, science proficiency. And poverty doesn't seem to be an indicator, because for Kenya's average grade 6 learner is reportedly 2 to 3 years ahead of the average grade 6 learner in South Africa's Eastern Cape province. So there are long, long-running problems, and these reports are saying the solutions lie in rooting out corruption. That's something that's been a problem for a long time. There's a stranglehold in some people's perception of teachers' unions over the Department of Education. The performance of teachers themselves needs to be improved. In South Africa, for example, maths proficiency amongst teachers sits around 41%.
Oh, my gosh.
Whereas in, again, Kenya, you've got 95% of teachers are proficient in maths and 87% of Zimbabwean teachers. So there's a long, long road to walk. And part of the solution is going to be to set realistic goals, not just at a national level, but also provincial levels, and actually assign budgets to that. More frequent testing of learners, more frequent testing and perhaps ongoing training of teachers, and a big, strong call for fresh leadership at the ministerial level. We've had the same Minister of Basic Education for a long time, and we're seeing very little change, and it's the learners who are suffering. So, the authors of these reports are saying, look, it's time for civil society, business, all political parties and parents and the public to just put pressure on the government and push for some reforms in the system, because it's our learners who are losing. And again, it's the poorest of the poor who are losing the most in our education system.
And we empathise, Mark. We have similar, very different drivers here in New Zealand, but similar problems with our education system. So we watch with interest. Thank you very much for your time, Mark Routon, our correspondent out of Cape Town. It's 6 minutes to seven.
Happening now.
Proposed changes to the Therapeutic Products Bill look set to have a huge impact on people with life-threatening illnesses. Importing medicines by post would be banned, with one cancer patient saying the cost of her drugs will go from $1,000 to $10,000 a month. Federated Farmers is concerned about the quality of the East Coast Slash inquiry. It wants the deadline pushed back to ensure it's not rushed. New SEEK data shows advertised salaries grew 4.4% in the year to February. The job site says it's close to the fastest recorded growth in the data set. And a bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells. Inter Islander and Bluebridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Oh my goodness, after much hullabaloo, kind of nothing has happened with this grand jury deliberating on whether to indict former President Donald Trump. It's now not expected to hear evidence until later next month. And this, of course, comes despite Donald Trump's prediction several weeks ago that he was going to be arrested last week. Let's bring in our correspondent Will Denslow from New York with the latest. Will, why the delay?
Oof, well, hullabaloo is absolutely right. Of course, let's not forget that back in March, about 10 days ago, as you rightly said, Donald Trump warned that he would be arrested. He urged his supporters to protest. He said there could be death and destruction. As he put it, of course, that has the media and much of the public on tenterhooks as to whether we would see the first president or former president ever be arrested. Now, of course, it's all subject to change when the grand jury might next convene to discuss the matter of Donald Trump's potential arraignment. They met this grand jury in Manhattan on Monday to discuss the case. They will be now turning their attention to a different case when they next meet on Thursday. But then there is a planned several-week hiatus, which, as you rightly mentioned, means they might not get back to discussing Donald Trump until late April. Now, there is no deadline on when a grand jury must make this indictment, but of course, as this highly anticipated wait is set to continue for at least a few more weeks.
All right, well, thank you very much. We will wait and watch with interest, as we have been. Our correspondent, Will Denslow, there out of New York City. It's 5 minutes to seven.
We've got a group of people, thanks, both Cam, in New Zealand and overseas, who see the shooter. Well, they refer to him as saint. So there's people who absolutely applaud what he did, which is horrendous.
That is Paul Spoonley there, the director of the Centre of Countering Violent Extremism. He talked in our interview earlier this week about the terrorist who was talking there about the terrorist who carried out the Christchurch mosque attacks in 2019. And he told us that white supremacy is now the prevailing extreme violent ideology in Aotearoa. Queensland is the latest Australian state moving to ban swastikas after neo-Nazis, and then after neo-Nazis showed up at Posey Parker's rallies in Melbourne. Victoria and Tasmania are banning the Nazi salute as well. Neo-Nazis reportedly did the same here. Sig Hailing at Parker's attempted rally in Auckland over the weekend. So will we consider banning the Nazi salute or swastikas as well? Justice Minister Kitty Tapu-Allen, that seems like something we should consider.
Yeah, look, it's not something that's come before my mind.
I'm putting it before your mind right now because the Centre for Preventing Violent Extremism says white supremacy ideology is the prevailing violent ideology in New Zealand right now.
Yeah, well, you'll see that the intelligence organisations and agencies provide to a select committee that they've been doing a lot more scrutiny and surveillance of white supremacist organisations, and it led to three further interventions that they say protected lives. It's certainly been a significant focus of our government, particularly since Christchurch.
I know all of these things, sorry to be rude, but would you consider banning the Sig Hail, banning the swastika, as Tasmania and Victoria have done?
Yeah, it's not something that I've considered. I can't kind of announce policy on the hoof. I'd have to
Go and have a look at it, though. It's a worthwhile policy. I mean, the Attorney General in Victoria said at the time the Nazi symbol glorifies one of the most hateful ideologies in history. Its public display does nothing but cause further pain and division. That seems like reason enough to go and at least take a look, doesn't it?
Yeah, look, I'm absolutely happy to take a look at something like that. I'm also thinking right now that young prince, as he once was, didn't he don a Nazi insignia and undertake some kind of act? I don't know if that was in a hate way. He said it was in a playful way. So it does bring into my mind just a broader range of considerations that no doubt we'll have to balance as we go through that. But no,
you wouldn't want to lock Prince Harry up. And just finally, Minister, name suppression. You said you're seeking urgent advice on that back in November last year. Where's that at?
Yes, I did. Actually, there's a raft of kind of advice that has come through in terms of the types of legislative amendments that we can make. It's quite a challenging area. Officials are working through that with the legal profession and with other stakeholder groups.
All right, Minister, thank you very much for your time. We'll continue to talk about name suppression in future interviews. Appreciate it.
Cheers.
Isn't that interesting? I love what the Attorney General in Victoria said about, so when they were celebrating, they said it was a proud day when they banned the swastika. And they said at the time that the Nazi symbol glorifies one of the most hateful ideologies in history. Its public display does nothing but cause further pain and division. What do you guys think? Should we ban the swastika? It's a no-brainer to me. And also ban the Sig Hail. Put some repercussions in there. Put a fine onto that. Discourage that kind of disgusting behaviour, especially as white supremacy rises in New Zealand. We're going to talk more about the second harbour bridge crossing. Most definitely need a second harbour crossing, but it needs to be future-proof, says James. So that meets the demands of the next 100 years and then some. The tunnel is the best option. Let me know your thoughts. 3920.
Streaming around the globe on the Rover app, this is Today FM News.
Doubt Stuart Nash will face further persecution despite an inquiry being launched. Concerns about proposed changes to the therapeutic products bill.
And in sport, a new record crowd for a women's rugby match will be set. I'm John Day.
And I'm Carly Flynn at 7. A political pundit believes Stuart Nash's latest indiscretion is unlikely to hurt Labour's election chances. The former minister was stripped of his roles by the Prime Minister after sharing private cabinet details with donors. Grant Duncan believes most voters will forget about it by October.
You can see the opposition National Party is particularly trying to up the ante and have deeper and deeper inquiries. The average member of the public starts switching off after a while.
There are calls for the inquiry into forestry slash to be extended. Federated Farmers is concerned there's not enough time with a report due at the end of April. Spokesperson Toby Williams says the East Coast can't afford it to be rushed.
Since 2018, in the Queen's Birthday flood at Tolaga Bay, we've had mounting issues with forestry byproducts ending up on the downstream properties, on our beaches and in our water, interfering with how people go about their lives.
A warning of the impact proposed changes to the Therapeutic Products Bill will have on people with life-threatening illnesses. It would ban the importation of prescription medicines by post. Lung cancer patient Teresa Zami says it will have a huge impact.
The drug we could purchase in New Zealand would cost us $10,000 a month, as opposed to the drug that we purchase from Bangladesh is $1,000 a month.
New Zealand is one of 18 nations to successfully push a UN resolution holding countries accountable for environmental failures. Youth activists from Vanuatu led the charge with hopes of safeguarding the Pacific from nuclear testing. Oxfam's Nick Henry was impressed with the campaign.
To see Pacific youth standing up and succeeding in calling on the world's governments to take stronger action on climate change, that's really inspiring for us and a lead we want to stand with.
A cyclist has been critically injured following a crash involving a car in Auckland's Takanini this morning. It happened near the intersection of Walters and Grove Roads, with cordons in place and motorists asked to avoid the area.
To sport, and the record crowd for a women's rugby match set at last year's World Cup final will be broken next month. Over 42,000 fans watched the Black Ferns beat England at Eden Park, but that mark has already been beaten in ticket sales for the Six Nations clash between England and France at Twickenham to be played on April 30th. The Warriors are taking no chances over the health of Tamari Martin after he failed to finish last week's dramatic win over the Bulldogs with a concussion. The playmaker retired 3 years ago after being diagnosed with a small brain bleed, only to make a comeback last year at the Broncos after getting medical clearance. It's a delicate situation for coach Andrew Webster.
If there's any symptoms or anything like that, then we will have a look because of the past. But right now, we're just going to stick to the protocols and see how that goes.
Rugby league with Machinery House and a league of their own. I'm John Day from Today FM, where our greatest Kiwi of all time countdown continues. Number 81 is coming at 8:30. You can vote at today. FM.co.nz.
This year, the country will decide which direction we want to go.
Left or right.
And we'll talk to the people who could be in the driver's seat and help you make the call that could change which road we take.
Rachel Smalley.
I swear, in the next election, I'll vote for the party that just has the most common sense.
Tova O'Brien.
I don't think I have been this excited about a year since 2020, which may or may not have something to do with my sick love of that election.
Duncan Garner.
The forgotten people have the power of the pen in the voting booth. The little people who are sick of being ignored.
Parnipper and Mark Richardson.
I'm sort of with you, actually. Oh, I think there should be a snap election.
What? Hang on. I mentioned that on Thursday and I was poo-pooed for my prattle.
You might have been pooed, but not poo-pooed.
Ah.
Lloyd Burr.
The time of Jacinda Ardern, it is over, ushering in the Chris Hipkins era, or the Hipkinsian era, one could argue.
We'll follow the stories, ask the questions, and chase down the truth, getting both sides of the story.
Which direction do you want to take?
On Today FM.
Hard news, no fluff. It's Tova.
Tova O'Brien.
On Today FM.
Kia ora, good morning, Aotearoa. You're listening to Today FM. I'm Tova O'Brien. Coming up just ahead, 20 years with no answers on the whereabouts of Waikato mum Sarah Neath. We speak to the private investigator looking into her disappearance and a Welshman who completed his New Zealand citizenship in Te Reo Māori. The video of it is going viral. We talk to the man himself. It's 4 minutes past seven.
Tova, Today FM.
Prime Minister Chris Hipkins has ordered a review of all correspondence between sacked Minister Stuart Nash and his donors. It's also been revealed that staff in the Prime Minister's office knew about Nash's email to two of his donors in which he told them top secret cabinet business. It seems that PMO worked with Nash's office, this is back in 2021, to keep that email, that smoking gun email, out of the public domain. And apparently they didn't tell the Prime Minister, Jacinda Ardern. Plausible deniability or just, I don't know, bovine scatology, I don't know. New Zealand First, Shane Jones, is really close friends with Stuart Nash. They had a big, long chat on Monday night over the phone. Morena Jonesy, welcome to the show.
Yeah, kia ora, greetings.
Did you offer Nash a place in your in New Zealand First?
No, there was none of my seductive charm at work. It was really a couple of mates talking, and obviously I want him to remain robust. In terms of his the bleak experience he's been through, and we washed up together in Labour Party candidate business in 2005. Mm. That's how long I've known him.
Yeah, I mean he screwed up though, didn't he? That's the long and the short of it.
Yeah, I mean he's been cack-handed. When you do engage in cabinet discussions and cabinet trade-offs, you really ought not to share them, and you most certainly should never send an email. And quite frankly, the email episode that you're talking about does have all the hallmarks of an act of vengeance, but obviously the people involved in sharing the email, they know what they've done. But you know, it sets in train a whole bunch of consequences when you start leaking. Mm. And those consequences end up being quite unpredictable. So if this review is as robust as the Prime Minister is referring to, the people who leaked the email will find that all of their other emails may very well fall into the purview of a review. So no doubt they're consulting QC lawyers today.
Right. Interesting. So do you or Stuart Nash have an inkling as to who leaked that email?
No. I mean, I was in cabinet at the time, but hey, all politicians gossip, and he has been cack-handed. But in this case, the existence of an email and its capacity to embarrass the Prime Minister. I mean, the Prime Minister is trying to rejuvenate Labour, okay? They're having a policy bonfire, but basically he's fueling the fire with the architecture he built himself. So, I mean, we'll put that hypocrisy to the side. But look, Stu Nash, he's a robust character. If he wants to continue in politics, he needs to go away and reflect on that. But it's a testing time for his character. And no doubt he'll consult his whānau and and dwell upon how he ended up where he is and think about the future. Don't dwell on the past.
He does. I'm just setting aside the fact that I do kind of disagree with you. I think that email should have been leaked. I think it probably should have been made public when it was requested under the Official Information Act back in 2021. But leaving that aside for a second, Stuart Nash, his future, he's lied to the Prime Minister, Jonesy. He said that there was nothing else in his closet when he was on his third strike. He's got to quit from Parliament altogether, doesn't he?
No, absolutely not. He may. I'm not aware of the circumstances of his court order with the Prime Minister. But no, he shouldn't be. He shouldn't be frog marched out of Parliament. The people of Hawke's Bay put him there, and it's up to the people of Hawke's Bay, not the Prime Minister's department, to destroy what's left of his career. Yeah, I mean, he's got elements that remind you of some of the farce out of British politics, where people disappear then they reappear again. Mm. So look, I would catastrophize it. It's not as if he's suffering an investigation from the Financial Markets Authority. And I mean, he does have a good knowledge of forestry, and forestry and the future of forestry and the and climate change is a big issue, and the government at the moment is botching that up. So whoever takes over his role has got big boots to fill.
He also has a lot of kind of policies and just methods, really, that align with you guys in New Zealand First. You're close with him. Would you want him in your party? Will you be perhaps using that seductive charm, to quote yourself?
Well, in the short term, we need to respect him. I mean, you know, I'm reminded of that line out of Shakespeare, if you prick us, do we not bleed? I mean, at the end of the day, he's a human being, and all the elements that make up his personality can be found any person down the road. But why him and I have always shared common interests, we're not interested in these fringe dwellers, such as what we saw over the weekend with that English lady being humiliated and threatened with violence by those fringe dwellers. He's more interested in the bread and butter mainstream issues that are going to turn around the fortunes of the country.
The fact that you're even talking about those fringe dwellers suggests that you're a little bit interested in the fringe dwellers. Have you ever, Jonesy, have you ever done a favour for a donor?
Now, how the system works is that you always declare who has provided money either for your constituency campaign or the party campaign. And I've always been a pro-industry politician. Less interested in political correctness and those other matters. I'm more interested, I think, along with guys like Stu Nash, the underlying issues that sort of inhibit us from rising and building our wealth in the country. And anyone who gives money to a politician, as prominent either as Stu or as, I wouldn't say inflammatory, but certainly as florid as my good self, they know what they're getting. They're getting someone who's going to advocate through the bureaucracy and within parliamentary politics for particular outcomes, whether it's predator-free, whether it's more respect for minorities, or whether it's growth in industry.
Did you say before that you should never do this in an email? Because that kind of suggests to me that you should do this. It's okay to give secret cabinet information out to donors, but just don't leave a paper trail, don't get caught.
Well, look, all politicians bring perspectives to cabinet committees or cabinet, but what happens in cabinet, it lies at the heart of our Westminster democracy. So it deserves to be treated with absolute secrecy. And then the Prime Minister or the officials eventually release the details, or if you'll give it a particularly challenging issue, as we saw through COVID, you try and let the people know as soon as possible what the position of the government is. Okay.
All right, we have to leave it there. Shane Jones, thank you very much for your time this morning. New Zealand First, Shane Jones there, leaving the door open to Stuart Nash. I think Stuart Nash has ruled it out, though. He's a Labour man through and through and through, isn't he? He's the great-grandson of Sir Walter Nash. It's 12 minutes past 7.
Tova O'Brien, Today FM.
Did I say great-grandfather? He's the great-grandson, because, yep, just to be clear. Oh, good. Flood-hit parts of West Auckland are urging the country not to forget about them. And we mustn't, guys. We must remember what's going on out there. They are still pushing for better support from officials. Many of them have been forced out of their homes by damage. They're running low on cash to pay for short-term rentals. Others have simply moved back into their dangerous homes. A petition's been launched asking for a government-funded managed retreat. Chair of newly formed advocacy group West Auckland is flooding. Lyle Carter joins us now. Thank you so much for being with us, Lyle. And I'm sorry that it is just such a proverbial storm out there for you still. Can we get a bit of a sense as to how residents are doing now?
Atamarie, good morning, Tova. Thanks for having me on this morning. Yeah, residents out in West Auckland are displaced and they are absolutely and utterly spent emotionally, financially, physically, mentally. We had a public meeting on Saturday just gone, and hearing some of the stories of PTSD, of children not being able to sleep when it rains, absolutely heartbreaking and harrowing and in equal measure. It's rough. It's a rough time for the people of flood-affected West Aucklanders.
I'm so sorry. And, you know, our hearts are still with you, though. I imagine it feels like you have been neglected and you've been left to fight this on your own. Do we have an idea how many people are still out of their homes or who think that their homes have been wrongly stickered as well?
Yeah, on the first question, just taking my street for example, I think one family have managed to move back into their homes, and we're now going on. We're pushing a couple of months since the floods. Insurance companies are doing the best that they can. It's not just what's happened in West Auckland, but also what's happened throughout the country that they're facing. So I would say that the vast majority of people are still displaced, still out of their homes and still paying for rentals as well as a mortgage. And so it is a really tough time for people
The moment. And what would that government-funded managed retreat look like? Because we want to help you fight for this.
Oh, thank you very much. Appreciate all the troops that we can gather on this to fight for managed retreat. So managed retreat, in really simple terms, has two aspects. One is retreat and one is retrofit. So retreat is coming up with an urgent and fair and equitable process to identify those homes that, no matter what flood mitigations, raising homes that we do, they will always be in harm's way. Mm-hmm. And so removing them out of harm's way. So that would be a voluntary buyout. So that's retreat. And then retrofit is raising homes, if there's room on the property to do so, and doing so, and flood mitigation, retention ponds, widening streams. We talk about streams in West Auckland, but they're not streams anymore.
No.
They're stormwater runoff.
Yeah.
So there needs to be responsibility needs to rest at the feet of somebody, and we really celebrate the direction that Mayor Brown is going in. That he just announced at the beginning of the week around clearing out of streams and landowners being responsible for those streams, because we hear anecdotally stories of private landowners who don't clean out their streams.
Yeah, all right, we have to leave it there, but we back you. Lyle Carter from Residents Advocacy Group West Auckland is flooding. Just imagine if it's your home and what you would want the government to do. And for all those people in West Auckland, they don't have to imagine. That's the reality they wake up to every single day. It's 16 past 7.
Happening now.
The government's being urged to extend the timeline of an inquiry into forestry slash on the East Coast. Federated Farmers says it's only fair given the recent ousting of Forestry Minister Stuart Nash. New Zealand has helped push a UN resolution holding countries accountable for environment failures. A group of youth activists from Vanuatu led the campaign, with Oxfam Climate Justice lead Nick Henry saying it's inspired all Pacific nations. A bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells. Inter-Islander and Bluebridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today. And Amsterdam has launched a new campaign to try and prevent rowdy sex and drug tourists from the UK. The country's trying to clean up its raunchy image, with its latest push targeting 18 to 35-year-old British men.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Something is rotten in the state of the beehive. First up, great great that the Prime Minister has asked the Cabinet Office to review all Stuart Nash's communications with his cash donors, but beyond appalling that the Prime Minister is using that as a smokescreen to hide behind and avoid accountability for a couple of months.
The advice I've had from the Cabinet Office is that, that will take around 2 months, and I will await the outcome of that review before making any further decisions or comment on it.
And zero assurances all communications will be actually reviewed, nor an explanation of this very questionable erasing of possible evidence.
Has he asked Stuart Nash why his Facebook account appears to have been deleted last night?
No.
Forestry, fishing, tourism. Nash has been, he's been Minister of Industries with very powerful lobbies, and he takes cash from them. And then what?
I will await the outcome of that review before making any further comment or decision on the matter.
And here's where the rot really starts to stink. When was the Prime Minister's office first made aware of the email which saw Nash sacked, the one where he divulged confidential cabinet information to cash donors with a vested interest in that information?
I did ask this morning or last night for a review to identify whether the office had in any way been aware of that communication prior to that. My understanding is that in 2021, Stuart Nash's then ministerial office consulted the office of the then Prime Minister on an Official Information Act request release, where that email had been identified as part of that release and had been identified as being outside the scope of the review. Neither the Prime Minister of the time nor the Prime Minister's Chief of Staff of the time were made aware of that.
Nicola Willis shouting out in the background there seems right. This does have the hallmarks of a cover-up. Jacinda Ardern's office knew. It looks like they colluded with Nash's office to keep that offending email, that smoking gun, a secret from the public. And what no one told the Prime Minister, the former Prime Minister or Chief of Staff, no one alerted this new Prime Minister even after he put Nash on his third and final warning. And then the Prime Minister, without even a hint of irony, declares that everything is hunky-dory, Stuart Nash is squeaky clean, has done everything by the book. What?
Mr. Speaker, I can confirm that all of Stuart Nash's donations, to the best of my knowledge, have been publicly declared and transparently so, and that any conflicts of interest that he had were registered with the Cabinet Office using the usual process.
Right, right. And this is the same Stuart Nash who gave the Prime Minister assurances that there were no other skeletons in his closet after those first three strikes. Something is very rotten. And just because Hipkins has cut out the source of the rot, I'm not feeling particularly assured that the government is going to get to the bottom of how deep that rot goes.
Tova.
Coming up, the private investigator who is selflessly, I'd say, helping a Waikato family with their final push for answers 20 years after their mum went missing.
Out now. Cyberbullies.
They just keep hammering.
Keyboard warriors.
The intent is to upset, menace and harass an individual.
And trolls.
Trying to like get a lift from someone.
They've started a war of words online and Kiwis are paying the ultimate price.
She said to her, please don't, because if you do, I'm going to kill myself.
From the public to the high profile.
A number of people who wished injury on me.
Trolls aren't only causing chaos in the digital world.
James Shaw blocked me, Helen Clark blocked me, Susie Wiles.
But also the real one.
Almost universally, the kind of terrorists who are predator trolls who then go on to do real life harm are talking about it on the internet.
Today FM investigates on social media following the trolls. Available to stream now on todayfm.co.nz. There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, call 0508 NetSafe 7 days a week. That's 0508 NetSafe. Or visit netsafe.org.nz.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? Paydayadvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, paydayadvance.co.nz.
TradeDepot.co.nz.
Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices.
TradeDepot.co.nz.
everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Want more entertainment for you and your family? We've got you covered with a $200 Spark gift card to spend in-store on all of your favourite ways to be entertained. From speakers and TVs to the latest headphones. Join Spark Broadband on an everyday wireless plus plan for your $200 gift card today. Limited time offer. Spark modem required. Cost applies. Wireless not available everywhere. Spark gift card and credit criteria apply.
Don't miss Noel Leeming's Mega Deals. Mega Deals on a range of tech from laptops to smartphones, vacuum cleaners, portable audio speakers, headphones, small appliances and more. Plus, flexible payment options to suit you. Explore free expert tech support. Conditions apply. Available at Noel Leeming.
Save 10 cents per litre on fuel today at Mobil. No minimum spend required for purchases up to 100 litres. Just scan or swipe your registered Mobil Smiles card. Get your discounts, earn Smiles points and redeem instantly. Visit mobilesmiles.co.nz. Exclusions apply.
Open your ears to open your mind.
The people changing the world are on Tova.
With Generate.
Awarded a Consumer New Zealand People's Choice Award for KiwiSaver.
On Today FM.
Well, this has got to be the story of the day for me. So when there's a threat of incoming... Doesn't sound like it's a good story, but this is cool. Bear with me. If there's a threat of an incoming Russian missile in Ukraine... there's a voice that comes out over everyone's phones, like, so it's heard by millions and millions of people warning them to take cover. And the person that has voiced those alerts is Luke Skywalker. Luke Skywalker is Mark Hamill, the actor who played like Luke Skywalker. He has lent his voice to the Air Alert app in Ukraine, which is linked to their air defence systems. He said he decided to do that after admiring the Ukrainian resistance to Russia's invasion last year, which he said evoked comparisons with Star Wars. We've got, I think, some of Luke Skywalker helping the people of Ukraine stay safe when Russian missiles are raining down.
Attention, air raid alert. Proceed to the nearest shelter. Oh. Don't be careless. Your overconfidence is your weakness. Attention, the air alert is over. May the force be with you.
No, he didn't. Oh, and I know, you know, like, we're not making light of the war, obviously, but it must also, just having a bit of levity must give people enormous heart, and just that reassuring voice of Luke Skywalker. I want him to do audiobooks for me. It's 25 minutes past seven.
Tova O'Brien.
Today.
Today marks 20 years since Waikato mother of three, Sarah Neath, was last seen alive. Her family is making one final push for answers. It took years for her then-partner, Mark Pakenham, to admit that she died after he injected her with methamphetamine. But he has never given up the location of her body. Sarah's kids describe her as a loving, free-spirited, barefoot-in-the-grass kind of a woman, and they have enlisted the help of a private investigator to help them find closure. We've got former police detective Bruce Curry, who's been on this case for the past 3 years, with us now. Bruce, amazing work that you're doing for this family. Thank you for joining us.
Yeah, hi, Tova. Yeah, great to be on the program.
What are some of the facts that we know for sure about the circumstances of her death?
Well, Sarah had gone out to visit Pakenham that particular day, and she didn't tell Mum where she was going, but she was expected to be home that night. She didn't arrive, and alarm bells started ringing the next morning. Mm. The first the family really knew about Pakenham's involvement was when he turned up at the family home at about 5:30 that night with Sarah's phone and her cigarettes, and said that she'd left them behind at his place the previous night.
Right. And then subsequently he's never said anything about where she might be. What does your gut tell you, your investigations tell you about her whereabouts?
Well, pretty confident that he disposed of the body and Sarah's vehicle, of course, which is still missing somewhere locally. He was able to be at work shortly after 7 o'clock the next morning, worked a full day, and then went to Sarah's house. So he didn't have any opportunity during the day to do anything. So it was all done the previous night.
How confident are you that you might be able to recover her body, and what would that mean to her family to be able to finally put her to rest?
Well, I'm pretty confident. Like you said, I've been working on it for about 3 years on a pro bono basis, trying to help them out. They're a young family. The children were 11, 9 and 7 when Mum was killed. And, you know, there's quite a few features of the case that just aren't right, and I'm pretty determined.
Yeah, and for them, what would that mean to that family?
Well, it certainly bring closure for the family. I've worked with them closely over the last 3 years, and I know how it's affected them so badly. And, you know, let's be honest about it, the system's let them down as well.
Yeah, it sure has, and that's why you are just doing, for not, I think, 800 hours, I read, Bruce, that you have done pro bono for this family. What can we do to help? What's your message out there to anyone out there who might know something?
Well, there are people in the Ngāti area that know about the case, and, in fact, we believe actually helped Pakenham. So we just want one of those people to make a call anonymously to us to tell us where to go. It's somewhere local. It's a place that he bragged about prior to killing Sarah to other people, saying that he had a place where a body could be concealed and never be found. And he's right. It's been missing for 20 years.
All right, Bruce. Well, we'll stay in touch with you, our producing team, and we wish you all the very, very best, and to Sarah's family as well. But just very grateful for your work. They're doing, I think, probably the work that police should also be doing a bit more to help. Private investigator Bruce Curry there. It is 29 minutes past 7.
Happening now.
The devastating impact of proposed changes to the Therapeutic Products Bill have been laid bare by a woman with lung cancer. Receiving medicines by post from overseas is set to be banned, a decision Theresa Zame says could result in her premature death. A cyclist has been critically injured following a crash involving a car in Auckland's Takanini this morning. It happened near the intersection of Walters and Grove Roads, with cordons in place and motorists asked to avoid the area. And a bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells. Inter-Islander and Blue Bridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today. A deep low east of the north directs a strong southerly flow over central New Zealand. The southerly flow gradually eases today as a ridge builds over the country, and then a trough spreads from the west on Saturday.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
We were talking earlier to the Justice Minister, Kitty Tapuwellen, about Nazi salutes and swastikas and whether they should be banned. This text in from Michael. Morning, Nova. It's Tova, but I like Nova. I'll go with that. Yes, definitely ban the swastika. Like abortion and assisted dying, free speech is not black and white. It requires careful consideration by experts regarding where the line should be drawn. I completely agree on those ones. I don't think there's much of a debate, though, is there, that they are symbols of hatred and they should be banned. Keep those texts coming in. The minister did promise to take a look at it for us. She said it's not on her list of priorities, but she did promise to take a listen. 3920. This is an interesting AI story. Every AI story is fascinating to me at the moment. But when editor Roberto Nixon discovered artificial intelligence, he wanted to test the limits of what it could do. So he decided to see if he could convert a rapper's voice onto his beat. He recorded a verse and had a trained AI model of Kanye West, yay, whatever his name is these days, replace his vocals. Here are the results, and they are scary good.
And I started thinking, you know, what are the implications of this for the music industry? Now all you have to do is record reference vocals and replace it with a trained model of any musician you like, which is exactly what I did. I found this Kanye-style beat on YouTube. I wrote 8 bars, and I'm going to record them now, and then I'm going to have AI Kanye replace me. I got a fantasy that's beautiful, that's dark and twisted, but I attacked the whole religion all because of my ignorance. What was I thinking? That was some bitch shit. I lost Adidas, but I'm still Yeezy. Back in the kitchen, man, I'm a genius. Boys in the hood, just like I'm easy. Kanye, Weezy, Southside of Chicago, life ain't easy. All praise be to Lord Jesus, Donda, please rest easy. All right, let me cut it there. So let's hear those vocals I just recorded now with Kanye over them. Yeah.
I got a fantasy that's beautiful, that's dark and twisted. But I attacked the whole religion all because of my ignorance. What was I thinking? That was some bitch shit. I lost Adidas, but I'm still Yeezy. Back in the kitchen, man, I'm a genius. Boys in the hood, just like I'm easy. Kanye, Weezy, Southside of Chicago, life ain't easy. All praise be to Lord Jesus, Donda, please rest easy. All right, let me cut it there.
Yo, that new Yeezy track goes hard.
That's incredible and terrifying. It actually gave me goosebumps. Can we do one where we get ChatGPT or whatever it's called to write my show tomorrow, and then we get that Kanye voice technology to put my voice over the top of the whole ChatGPT thing and see if we can do an AI show? No, don't do it. I'll lose a job. Don't do that. 27 minutes to 8.
The impact and context of today's stories. Unpacked after 9. The news and your issues and stories coming up Sir Duncan Garner today. After the 9 a.m. news on Today FM.
It's time to cut and run. This time I'm really done.
Is your team driving today? Restricted drivers are more at risk of crashing when driving with friends. There's a reason for the restrictions. Home by 10 p.m. No passengers.
Bathroom moisture from shower steam. It's a problem in most homes. So eliminate steam with a Shower Dome shower top. With Shower Dome, you get a warmer, drier bathroom and a lifetime guarantee. That'll give you the warm fuzzies. Showerdome.co.nz.
Battery Town, Battery Town. If your battery is letting you down.
Is your vehicle sounding slower to start? Get it tested at your local Battery Town workshop now. For all car, truck, motorcycle or motorhome batteries before you get stuck. With over 90 stores nationwide, there's one near you. Call 0800 566 667.
There's only one place to go and that's Battery Town.
Save 10 cents per litre on fuel today at Mobil. No minimum spend required for purchases up to 100 litres. Just scan or swipe your registered Mobil Smiles card. Get your discounts, earn Smiles points and redeem instantly. Visit mobilesmiles.co.nz. Exclusions apply.
A spin doctor somewhere is having a bad day.
Thanks to Tova. Drilling for the truth for you. With Generate. Switch to an award-winning KiwiSaver provider today.
On Today FM.
Someone says, so we've been talking this morning, we had a chat with the Justice Minister earlier about whether we should ban swastikas and Sig Hailing like they're doing in some states in Australia. One person says, great idea, can we force mongrel mob members to remove their swastika and SS tattoos as well? Well, no, we can't force anybody to remove their tattoos, but actually in some of those Aussie states they do, they have banned tattoos, so I suppose people aren't allowed to do them, tattoos of those Nazi hate symbols, and you'd have to have it covered up as well. So I don't think we could force people to remove their tattoos, but yes, I include the mongrel mob in this ban as well. It's 23 minutes to 8. Get in touch and let me know your thoughts on this. 3920. The Justice Minister said she's open to it.
Tova's Debate Club. Roll call.
Hello, John Day and Carly Flynn. How are you?
Hello, well.
Morena.
Today is maybe case in point. Have I been too hard on Stuart Nash? Are we too hard on politicians? That's our debate club moot today.
I like Shane Jones's comment. Was it to quote Shakespeare or somebody about cutting and not bleeding? But if you do cut, you do bleed and we're all human?
Yeah.
But I don't know.
I just like interviewing Chaucer, that man. And I was never very good in my first year English classes, classic English classes. What do you think, JD? They've got to take it.
Yeah. Yeah. It's like All Blacks coach, right? Like, it's the job. You're not attacking the man. You're attacking the job that they're doing. And as soon as you slip up, there's always someone who kind of wants blood or someone from the opposition who's going to go on strong, or political reporters like yourself, Tova, who go for the jugular. So, and that's fair enough. It's what we demand from the position. So I don't think we're too harsh on our politicians.
Ooh, good stuff.
Accountability. Yeah. I completely agree. Let us know what you think. 3920, if we're too hard on politicians. And in the meantime, who's got the coin today to determine what's up?
Well, I have one, but would you like it, JD?
Or
have you?
No,
okay,
no,
good.
No.
You never know. I've always got one. All right, so heads, you'll be affirmative. Tova and tails, Duncan will be affirmative. It's tails. So Duncan has to argue today that we're too hard on politicians.
Oh, that's going to be interesting because having worked with Duncan, he hired me in the press gallery and he told me a thing or two about the approach I should take to being hard on politicians, which I might pull out of my grab bag of anecdotes about nice. Duncan Garner for the debate club moot. We're arguing at 8:45 this morning. Let us know in the meantime. Thanks very much, guys. 3920, let us know your thoughts on that moot. We are too hard on politicians, yes or no? 21 minutes to 8. Epic. Welshman Ewan Jones completing his citizenship ceremony here in Aotearoa in Te Reo Māori. The clip has gone viral after his partner posted it, I think unknowingly for him, posted it to TikTok. 27-year-old Ewan Jones joins us now from Picton. Morena, Ewan, welcome.
Morena, Tova.
That was amazing. Well, congratulations on your citizenship, first of all. Why did you decide to do your ceremony in Te Reo Māori?
It's probably a good question. Being Welsh and from, I guess, what you'd call a minority language back in the UK, it means quite a bit to me to represent the language, I guess. And so for the council to give me the opportunity to do it in Te Reo, meant quite a bit to me. So.
Yeah. Can you tell me a little bit about your first language, as you say, a minority language under the crown in Wales? Tell me a bit about it.
Yeah, so the language Cymraeg, it's probably one of the oldest languages in Europe. And the Cairns, the English language, I guess, has done a pretty good job at trying to sort of stamp it out. But thankfully, we're going through a bit of a resurgence now, especially in the last sort of 60 years. The language is just getting stronger, so we can only hope the same for Te Reo as well.
Yeah, completely agree, and thank you for doing your bit. So your missus posted it on TikTok. Did you know?
No, I didn't have a clue, to be honest. I'm not on TikTok myself.
Sensible man.
So she just told me a few days ago that it had gone viral, I guess, so.
And yeah, it's gone enormously viral. It's like over 135,000 views now. What did you make of the fact that it has taken off the way it has?
I didn't expect it to mean so much to so many people, to be honest. We spent a few nights ago, I guess, we spent some time reading the comments and there was quite all of them were basically positive comments. So I just want to thank everyone for that. It means a lot to me.
Nice one. Well, thank you very much again for doing it as well, Ewan, and for being such a proponent of our native tongue, Te Reo Māori. Thank you very much for joining us as well this morning, and congrats again on your citizenship.
Thank you, Tova. Cheers.
Cheers. It's Ewan Jones there, officially a New Zealand citizen after completing that final step, his ceremony in Te Reo Māori. I remember a couple of years back when I was the Europe correspondent for News Hub interviewing a young woman called Aoife Finn, who in Dublin, she's Irish, who was doing, I think it was her doctorate in Te Reo Māori, and she was a fluent speaker. I think she is now a fluent speaker of Māori, and it's just amazing to see people from all over the world getting in behind the reinvigoration of Te Reo. It's 18 minutes to 8.
Happening now.
The devastating impact of proposed changes to the therapeutics products bill have been laid bare by a woman with lung cancer. Receiving medicines by post from overseas is set to be banned, a decision Theresa Zame says could result in her premature death. A bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells, and Rylander and Bluebridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today. And King Charles has left the comfort of London to travel abroad for the first time since becoming the British monarch. He arrived in Germany this morning, where he'll spend 3 days in efforts to reset relations post-Brexit. Visits to France were cancelled amid violent protests. A deep low east of the north directs a strong southerly flow over central New Zealand. The southerly flow gradually eases today as a ridge builds over the country, and then a trough spreads from the west on Saturday.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
From April the 1st, New Zealand Super will be $496 for a single person living alone and $381 each for couples per week. And once that might have sounded like a lot, but today, and certainly by the time I retire, it won't stretch far at all. A good KiwiSaver strategy is non-negotiable. So I arranged, about a year ago when I first started this job, I arranged to sit down with a KiwiSaver advisor from Generate. A huge number of Kiwis are in default funds getting default results, but with Generate, there is no default. There are no obligation. Meetings are the perfect opportunity to get proactive and save for the retirement you want. They come to you, they explain all the details, they help you set up your KiwiSaver account the smart way to maximise your savings. That is the kind of service that won them both the Investor Choice and the Advisor Choice Awards at the Fund Manager of the Year Awards 2022, and a Consumer New Zealand People's Choice Award as well. Search Generate KiwiSaver to book a meeting with one of their friendly advisors, because smart advice now could make a significant difference to your retirement savings. Head to generatekiwisaver.co.nz for a copy of their product disclosure statement. Remember, past performance is not a reliable indicator of future returns. The issuer is Generate Investment Management Limited.
Today FM's $1,000 question.
Birds. Our boss asked, our boss who generates the $1,000 questions, asked in our meeting last night what the topic should be, and producer Tom said birds. Goodness knows where he got that from, but Kylie Gray, that is your topic this morning. How confident are you on the area of birds?
Not very.
neither particularly, but you never know. You never know. The topic usually is a fairly vague indicator of what's actually to come. What are you going to spend $1,000 on, Kylie Gray, if you win?
I haven't decided yet.
Oh, that's quite nice. Wait for it to come into your bank account and then make the call.
We'll see.
Yeah, no. Any inklings? Are you going to treat yourself, maybe?
Maybe, or I'm most likely to treat my son.
Nice. Now, how old's your boy? Away.
He's 13 months.
13 months? Oh, okay. We need you to win this today, Kylie. Let's give it a go. You've got 7 seconds to answer the question correctly. And if you do, $1,000 for you and your son. Okay, Kylie, how many pieces of chicken in a KFC deluxe quarter pack?
Three.
With loads of time to spare, Jeremy, can I get a... Whoa! Yes!
That's a good one.
Turns out you do know about birds, the Kentucky Fried variety.
I know a bit about KFC, that's for sure.
Kylie, we are thrilled for you. How do you feel?
Oh, I'm stoked. I wasn't expecting that.
No, I never know which way it's going to go, and I'm just utterly over the moon. Bird. What's your son's name?
Jackson.
Jackson. Okay, well, congratulations to you and Jackson. Thank you so much for playing and for listening, Kylie. Congratulations.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Yes, I love it when we come up with the money. Pai Corridor is next. We've got Kitty Tapu Allen and Chris Bishop on with us. Then we're talking more about the Stuart Nash spiral with our political editor, Joe Moyer, after 8.
The news hit you need on your drive home. Lloyd Burr Live.
As I said, while some argue that teachers shouldn't be paid more because they're failing to teach our kids the basics when it comes to reading, writing and maths, the counter-argument, I guess, is that if we do pay them properly to start with, better people would be enticed to get into teaching as a career. And then the results with our kids would show.
Hard news at the speed of sound. Lloyd Burr Live with Lexus. Weekday afternoons from 4 on Today FM. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices. TradeDepot.co.nz. Everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door. TradeDepot.co.nz.
There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, call 0508 NetSafe 7 days a week. That's 0508 NetSafe. Or visit netsafe.org.nz.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? Paydayadvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, paydayadvance.co.nz.
Man needs meat. You office workers need meat.
It gives you strength to laugh at your boss's inappropriate jokes, the energy for idle chit-chat at the coffee machine. And you know you can't spell meetings without meat, right? Get some Jack Link's beef jerky into your drawers. And I mean the ones under your desk. You don't need HR asking awkward questions again, do you? Jack Link's. Feed your wild side.
Secure your dream Mercedes-Benz with exceptional end-of-financial-year savings. From sporty compacts and luxurious sedans to spacious SUVs, these outstanding offers across a select range of models could save you thousands. The offers are sure to move you, but they end 31st of March. So visit your local authorised retailer today or browse available vehicles online. Terms and conditions apply.
News every 12 minutes over your breakfast.
Nobody has more news and fewer ads than Tova.
With Generate, switch to an award-winning KiwiSaver provider today.
Today FM.
Well, we just gave away $1,000 and that feels really, really good. It is coming on 10 minutes to 8, and we should get this out there. It's less than 24-hour time frame for public submissions on the second cyclone recovery bill. It's been criticised as a farce of the parliamentary process. I would agree with that. The Government and Administration Select Committee emailed at 9 p.m. last night calling for submissions by 5 p.m. today. The chair of the Select Committee, National MP Ian McKelvey, absolute legend, he stands by that expedited process, and he said that there is precedent for bills of a similar nature to progress at a similar speed, citing the legislation after the earthquakes in Christchurch and Kaikoura. Okay, maybe I've done a 180 here. Maybe we do need to get these things just going really quickly, though. 9 p.m. till 5 p.m. seems a little bit rushed. Let me know your thoughts. Matt texts in as well, saying pretty disappointed that Tova let Shane Jones indicate that Posey Parker was bullied by the people supporting our trans whānau without even trying to correct him. I know that she knows what happened, and it feels like Tova was enabling Jones to punch down. Matt, go and check out my editorial that I wrote off the back of attending that counter protest. I'm not going to get into it today again, and that's why I didn't get into it with Shane Jones. You know how I feel about all of this. I know how you guys feel. We've had enormous conversations about it over the last week, and frankly, I would quite like to move on from that chat. 3920, it's 9 minutes to 8.
Happening now.
A plea for the government not to follow through with proposed changes to therapeutic products bill, which would see the importation of prescription medications by post banned. One lung cancer patient says she would save thousands of dollars a month by flying overseas to purchase life-saving drugs. A cyclist has been critically injured following a crash involving a car in Auckland's Takanini this morning. It happened near the intersection of Walters and Grove Roads. With cordons in place, and motorists asked to avoid the area. A bunch more ferry cancellations across the Cook Strait due to high swells. Inter-Islander and Bluebridge won't be sailing between Wellington and Picton for much of today. And Pope Francis has been hospitalised with a respiratory infection. The Vatican says he has breathing difficulties and will spend a few days in care, but denies the pontiff has COVID.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Tracy writes in and says, are you aware that the mongrel mob use of the swastika symbol in the Sig Heil? They use it as well. My point is, I've never seen any white supremacists. I saw a couple at the counter protest this weekend, but this person, Tracy, hasn't. I'm sure they're out there, but I haven't seen them. I've seen plenty of mob, though. Some of them are my bros. I don't believe white supremacy is the big thing that you're making it out to be. All spin, bro. Thank you very much for that, Tracy. We don't take my word for it. Take the spies who were in front of Select Committee Parliament this week, and also take Paul Spoonley, who is one of the co-directors at the Centre for Preventing Violent Extremism. I can't remember the exact name of it. We talked to him earlier this week.
The group that assesses the threat level is called CTAG,
yeah.
Combined Threat Assessment Group, and they are still saying very clearly that the major threat comes from ideologically motivated extremism, and mostly that's white supremacy.
So there you go, white supremacy, the prevailing extreme violent ideology in New Zealand.
Pai Kōrero.
It's Tova.
Yay, it's time to bring in Labour Minister Kiri Tapu Allen and National's 3IC Chris Bishop. Morena Kōrero, welcome.
Morena, first Thursday.
Good morning.
Oh yeah, welcome to Thursday, guys. How does it feel for size?
Oh, it's cool. I'm into it. It's the end of the week. You can have a bit of a yarn, you know?
Yeah, you guys are going to get loose. Let's get loose. Let's talk about Stuart Nash and Chris. I'll give you a bit of a free hit on this one because, I think I probably agree with you guys, the fact that the Prime Minister's office and Nash's office both knew about this email divulging cabinet secrets to donors and they worked to keep it out of the public domain. Cock up or conspiracy?
It's a very, very serious matter. And what happened yesterday was that Chris Hipkins admitted in Parliament that basically in 2021, the Prime Minister's office, which would have been Jacinda Ardern at the time, obviously, knew about this email to this donor, to Stuart Nash, and basically didn't do anything with it. They knew about it, but didn't do anything. And, you know, frankly, I think that is appalling. If that had happened under the last National Government, heads would roll and there would be an inquiry. And all hell would break loose, yeah. Quite frankly. I think it's an absolute shocker.
Yeah, I completely agree, Kiri Tapu, and surely for the sake of democracy and accountability, you do too. There needs to be a full-blown inquiry and heads need to roll here.
Well, I do think, I agree on the extent that it was a massive cock-up. I think nobody can deny that. I think, as I best understand the lay of the land, what was happening is that it wasn't within the scope of that particular OIA, middle of living COVID, and it was just a massive stuff up. So look, I don't know what the next steps will be. That's not within my realm, but I don't think that we would deny at all that a stuff up has been made here.
What about,
can I just respond to that?
Please.
Can I just respond to that? I mean, so the way these things work, right, is the information goes up. And, okay, it's out of scope. Now, what that means is that it doesn't have to be released.
Mm-hmm.
But it does mean that someone in the office has seen it and gone, don't have to release that. But hang on, wouldn't you read that and go, hang on a minute, Stuart Nash is writing confidential information to anyone outside Cabinet. Better actually tell the boss about this, the senior leadership in the PMO, or the boss himself. Why didn't that happen? That's what's really,
and
really...
That's either stupid by not identifying that something is as serious as it was, or there is a cover-up here. That's what it kind of comes down to.
I don't think that's the case at all. But what I do think is that there was an absolute genuine stuff up here. And the problem we got a little bit is, and you guys know this, you've been a staffer, and look, you were a good staffer, and I take that. But it's just, what do you do in these circumstances? You find out a couple of years later, somebody did receive that information, absolutely should have gone up through the channels, and we can see that it hasn't. So, we're in the situation now, we've got to own that. Nobody else can own that but us. But it wasn't the right thing that happened there. There's no blame conspiracy theory. It just was a stuff up. It was in the middle of the most hectic time. And, we've got to, own it.
Okay. So what about, I like the idea of a full-blown audit, actually, of all of you, Chris, every MP, you, Kiri Tapu, every minister, all of your comms with donors, people who pay you money, could we do that?
I'd
would
be
you
happy
get behind
to do that?
That?
I mean, for me personally, sure.
The whole Parliament?
I don't know if Chris would want that. But look, one of the things that Prime Minister said in response to this, it'd be huge. That would take years. So look, I don't know if that's something we'll actually pursue.
Well, I mean, I think is it worth it, Bish, no matter how long it takes? And you don't need to go back forever. You could do a sample of, the year after an election, for example, and just see if there is a systemic problem here.
I think the issue is in relation to Cabinet, right, and in particular to Stuart Nash. And what we've said is that there should be an investigation. There's one underway, but the email issue we're talking about should be included within that. There should be an inquiry into exactly what Stuart Nash was up to. And so we're very keen to get to the bottom of that. And I think it looks like the government is as well. And so they should include this email exchange as part of it.
Okay. Have you guys...
absolutely agree with that. Yeah, look, I think that's absolutely appropriate. He was acting in a role as a minister. So we are going to undertake that review. It will be done by Cabinet Office. And we know it'll take that
few months. Have you guys ever done a favour for a donor or disclosed anything secret?
I'd love to. Oh, I think my donor list is pretty transparent and blunt. No.
That's a no.
These are such positions of privilege and power. No.
Bish, you've never disclosed anything secret, done a favour for a donor?
Absolutely not. We actually, I mean, I don't know how Labor works, but we have very little to do with actual fundraising. It's managed by our teams who support us.
We're expecting the government to confirm today that it's brought forward the construction of the Waitemata crossing, likely a tunnel from the 2040s to the 2020s. What can you tell us, Kiritapu?
Waitemata tunnel, well, not too much because it wasn't on my list of things to have a yarn about. And it's
popped up this morning.
I'd love to be able to give you more eloquent answers, but outside of my passion.
fair enough, and I think you probably echo a lot of New Zealanders this morning are like, shut up Auckland, we don't care. Do you think we're too hard on politicians?
I can tell you about the cut around the east coast though.
Yeah, wouldn't you, please. And actually, Bish, just before you go though, we're too hard on politicians, that's our debate club moot today. What do you reckon? You guys can take it, can't you?
It's a game we get into, and once you can't hack it, you've got to get out of it. So I don't think so. I mean, it's a tough game. People expect a lot from politicians, and I think that's fair enough. But I think we could all, as politicians, be a little bit more civil to each other and a bit more kind. There you go.
That's a lovely way to end it. Thank you very much, Chris, Kumbaya, Bishop and Kiritapu on the attack, Alan, this morning. We'll be back after the break with our political editor, Joe Moyer, for more on the Stuart Nash saga.
New Zealand's Today FM.
This is Today FM News.
A friend of Stuart Nash says his political blunders were cack-handed. A petition has been launched by flood-affected West Auckland residents.
And in sport, a new record crowd for a women's rugby match will be set at Twickenham. I'm John Day.
And I'm Carly Flynn at 8. A long-time political friend of Stuart Nash admits the former minister messed up. A review has been launched into his communication with donors after he sent emails which leaked cabinet information. Former NZ First MP Shane Jones told Tova O'Brien his actions were cack-handed.
He's a robust character. If he wants to continue in politics, he needs to go away and reflect on that. But it's a testing time for his character.
Shane Jones says other people also have a part to play in the leak. A woman with lung cancer has explained the devastating impact of proposed changes to the Therapeutic Products Bill. Receiving prescribed medicines by post from overseas is set to be banned, forcing costs to go up. Teresa Zame says it would end her life early.
I could look to take other medication, chemotherapy or first or second generation drugs that are similar, but unfortunately I will prematurely die.
Climate scientists warn catastrophic effects seen in 2004's The Day After Tomorrow movie may not be so far-fetched. The film tells of the collapse of the North Atlantic circulation. Australian researcher Matthew England says new models looking at the Southern Ocean paint a bleak picture.
According to this model, the decline we get around Antarctica is set to be even bigger than what will play out in the North Atlantic.
Auckland Council is being pleaded with to re-evaluate a number of homes impacted by the anniversary floods. There are calls for the government to intervene and organise a funded managed retreat in the city's west. Advocacy group chair Lyle Carter told Tova O'Brien people have no idea where to turn.
The vast majority of people are still displaced, still out of their homes and still paying for rentals as well as a mortgage. And so it is a really tough time for people.
To sport, and a new record crowd for a women's rugby match will be set next month. Over 42,000 fans watched the Black Ferns win the World Cup at Eden Park last year, but that number's already been broken in ticket sales for England's Six Nations clash with France at Twickenham on April 30th. Doubt remains over whether Warriors captain Tohu Harris will front in Sunday's NRL clash with the Sharks. He's been named at lock despite picking up a knee injury in last weekend's win over the Bulldogs. Coach Andrew Webster says Harris has done knees before and he knows his body.
Tohu's like a self-doctor. He's analysing it every day. Now here's a chance of playing. I'm going to give him later in the week to make that decision.
Rugby league with Machinery House in a league of their own. And Indonesia's been stripped of hosting rights for the Under-20 Football World Cup. The decision by FIFA comes after Indonesia, a predominantly Muslim country, refused to host Israel's team. The tournament kicks off in May. A new host will be announced as soon as possible. I'm John Day from Today FM, where our greatest Kiwi of all time countdown continues. Number 81 is coming at 8:30. Vote at todayfm.co.nz.
The debate begins in the morning.
Tova, you're in the affirmative. MPs should have terms imposed on them.
Tova and Duncan battle it out each morning.
Hell yeah, we need term limits. Can you imagine actual rejuvenation? Politicians who get in there, get it done, and then get the heck out of there?
Right, Tova, I want to address this with you directly. It's a stupid idea. It's been looked at before and ditched. Vote for me to get your democracy back.
Who are you and what did you do with Duncan Garner?
And then you can have your say throughout the day with Leah and Mark.
The male doctor and I went to see. Nowadays you have to have a woman in there. I mean, no.
Another person having a gander.
No, I'm not another.
We didn't set up a link.
And then from four, share your opinion with Lloyd Burr Live.
Titanic is the greatest movie ever. That is my opinion. Do you agree with me, Louisa?
No, you don't have an ally in me.
Following the issues that affect you right across the day. Be a part of the move for change on Today FM.
The people changing the world.
Every morning. With Tova O'Brien.
On Today FM. Because I'm TNT.
Kia ora, good morning, Aotearoa. You're listening to Today FM. I'm Tova O'Brien. Just ahead, she's a poster girl for conservative voters, an outspoken host for Fox News. We will talk to Tommy Lehren on her view on gun laws after this most recent tragic US shooting in a school. We are also, I've been a bit remiss and should update you on some of the greatest Kiwis of all time to date. We're going to hit number 81 shortly, but we've also had, since we last spoke, we have had Sam Hunt, Michael Hill, Dan Carter, AJ Hackett, Sir Howard Morrison, we did Temuera Morrison, Karen Walker, Sir John Kerwin, Alan McDermott, and Barry Crump, and Peter Gordon, most recently this morning. We will continue that at 8:30. Right now it is 5 minutes past eight.
Today FM.
The Stuart Nash saga continues. He is now being investigated, all his communications with cash donors being pored over after he emailed and divulged top secret cabinet information to two of his donors who had a vested interest in the policy they were discussing. And boy, did the plot thicken when we learnt yesterday that the Prime Minister's office and Stuart Nash's office appeared to collude to keep the offending email secret. We're told that the then Prime Minister Jacinda Ardern didn't know. Newsroom and Today FM political editor Jo Moyer is with us now. Morena, Jo, welcome.
Good morning, Tova.
If staff in the Prime Minister's office didn't tell her or her chief of staff about this email, which turned out to be a smoking gun, sackable offence email, surely someone loses their job for that.
Yeah, look, I mean, what we heard from the Prime Minister, Chris Hipkins, yesterday was that he had had a very serious conversation with his office about how important an email like that is and how, under his watch, he would expect an email like that to be raised to him personally. He says that did not happen. He has checked with both Jacinda Ardern and the former chief of staff. That in itself, I think, would be quite hard to stomach for quite a few people and swallow, that the idea that an email so incriminating, so egregious in terms of what the contents of that email were, was not sort of a big roaring red flag. Even if it was a junior staffer in the office who was dealing with this OIA, which, to be honest, people dealing with OIAs are pretty across this sort of stuff and have a pretty fair idea of, you know, what's potentially damaging and what not, to not sort of register that was a concern is actually quite sort of difficult to believe. There's obviously the accusations that this is a cover-up coming from National and the ACT Party. Whether we'll even know, it's a little bit hard to tell. It's kind of, their word against Chris Hipkins at the moment. But certainly, this review that Chris Hipkins announced yesterday as well into these communications between Stuart Nash and the donors is a little bit narrow as well, because it's only looking at those two donors that he, had this email exchange with previously.
Oh, really? I thought it was all of his donors. Is it just those two?
My understanding is that it is with the donors in question, and the call is that that it should go wider and it should look at all cabinet ministers and all communications. So, yeah, there's some questions there about sort of, why it is as narrow as it is. 2 months it's going to take for that review to come through. So, the other thing there is that it's going to cast quite a big shadow for some time yet, and we're going to be getting pretty pretty close to the 2023 campaign period by the time a lot of this stuff gets cleared up and we get some more answers around this too.
And what about Stuart Nash? So is he denying that he knew about this? I mean, he wrote the email, so he knows about it. But is he denying that he knew about it when it was kind of being poured over again in 2021?
Yeah, I mean, look, there hasn't been any word from Stuart Nash as to what he did or didn't know about the email at that time. What we were told yesterday, at least anyway, by the Prime Minister, was that it was an office-to-office conversation. So it wouldn't necessarily have been discussed with the Minister at the time. That was certainly kind of the, you know, what was left lingering from the conversation that Chris Hipkins had about it yesterday. That doesn't mean to say that that conversation didn't happen. It didn't mean to say that, you know, he hadn't had it kind of, you know, flagged to him again. I mean, all of this boils down to the fact that, you know, 10 days ago or so now, Chris Hipkins did, on that final warning, say to Stuart Nash, look, is there anything else?
Yes,
go
exactly.
through everything. Think about it. I would have thought that something like this would be kind of front of mind, really, as something that
Hard agree. Yes, and then that, to me, just looks like he's actually lied to the Prime Minister, which is really, and I know that's a bad word to say, and we've got to be on very solid ground when we say it, but I'm just going to throw it out there, because this should have been front of mind. He either lied or he was really dumb.
Yeah, it's a difficult one to understand how that wouldn't have registered. And look, it might have been a case of thought, who knows, it's not going to get out there. Although he knew that the email was out in the public sphere. I mean, there's lots of things rumbling around this morning about how many people actually had it. There's some speculation that the ACT party had it, and that was how the Stuff's news office ended up publishing it the other night. So it looks as though, you know, a lot of people have had this email for some time, and presumably Stuart Nash had, you know, knew it had gone fairly far and wide. And also the fact that it, you know, popped up as something that ended up not being in scope for that Official Information Act request, but, you know, popped up in the system. It was obviously pretty freely available.
Yeah. Joe, thank you so much. And I watch with interest your reporting on this ongoing story, because it does feel like just the very beginning of the, you know, when a little strand, a loose thread comes off the bottom of your dress hem. And it just feels like that loose strand is just beginning to be pulled, and someone's going to end up naked pretty soon. Joe Moyer, our political editor, Newsroom's political editor there, 8:10. And there, I've just had a text from a friend who is at the Prime Minister's breakfast this morning, then just confirming that second harbour crossing by 2029, brought forward by 11 years, shovels in the ground by then, is what I'm told. It's 8:11. Oh, nice. That's the sound of Carol Ramos entering the building. Our beautiful, our magnificent, our brilliant Hollywood reporter. Carol, welcome.
Good morning, Tova. Coming to you from a nice, sunny La La Land. No rain today so far, and it's looking great.
Oh, well, receiving you from a very chilly and crisp Tamaki Makaurau this morning, Carol. Can I play you this little clip, Carol, just one moment?
And he has deterred you from enjoying the rest of what was a very expensive vacation.
Well, I lost half a day of skiing.
Gwyneth has become a meme. What did you make of that? She's gone viral for all the wrong reasons, hasn't she, Carol?
Yes and no. Actually, Tova, you know, as I was telling your producer, Carol, she has gotten very popular in the last week, not because of her testimony, but because of what she's wearing. Nobody seems to be paying attention to how she's coming across on the stand, but they are referring to her immaculate blonde waves that look like ripples, her gold statement jewelry, a bone broth-hued tote, and a slim-cut gray blazer. So she has basically wowed everyone with her low-key rich style, and nobody seems to be paying much attention to what she's saying. The trial is supposed to wrap up tomorrow, but, you know, it's all come down to who do you believe. Skier etiquette says the person who's downhill has the right of way, and she and everyone who has testified on her behalf has said that she was downhill. So we'll see how this ends. My prediction is maybe the jury comes back and says, we can't make up our minds. And Gwyneth goes, you know what? That's good enough for me. And maybe she'll pay this man's medical bills. And that's how it will end.
Yeah,
or they could just say, you know what? You know what? We believe her, which I don't know if that's going to happen or not. But one way or the other, she will always look good.
That's so true. You're not wrong there at all. And, you know, it has been... I don't know if I'm making light of it, but it has been very entertaining. That meme, a particular favourite of mine. Speaking of favourites, a Hollywood favourite who hasn't been in public for a while is set to make a big comeback soon, Carol. Who are we talking about?
Jeremy Renner, believe it or not. After his New Year's Day snowplow accident, he has been the last few months in rehab, healing from 8 broken ribs, right knee, left ankle, right ankle, right shoulder, right clavicle. All those things were broken. He's had several surgeries. He did his first primetime interview, which will air next week here. And he was asked by Diane Sawyer if he was awake and felt the pain when he was involved in the accident. And he said, I felt every moment of it. Oh. But he is going to be making a public appearance here in LA on April 11th to promote his new series on Disney Plus called Renovations. So we're all cheering for Jeremy Renner. He really, really dug in deep, got his superhero powers out, and he's on the mend.
Adding our voice to those cheers. What is the iconic 90s TV series that may be getting a reboot, Carol?
Black Panther director Ryan Coogler is set to reboot The X-Files without Mulder and Scully.
Oh.
So speaking on the Canadian radio show On the Coast, the original series creator Chris Carter revealed that this version will take the story to a different direction with a diverse cast. Now, as you recall, and I loved X-Files, that show was all based on conspiracy theories and how ridiculous they were and how they were trying to prove they weren't true. What do you do nowadays when everybody believes conspiracy theories? They're out there everywhere, and people seem to think that they're the truth. I mean, the truth is out there.
The truth is out there. Oh, I wait with interest for that one, but yeah, I'm not going to watch an X-Files, which is all about vaccines and 1080. Thank you so much, Carol, for your time. Always such a pleasure to speak with you. Our LA entertainment reporter, Carol Ramos, there. It's 8:15.
Happening now.
Police have been given the power to bring down drones if they're being flown in a dangerous manner. It's been announced as part of a shake-up to aviation rules. Other changes include random drug testing for workers in safety-sensitive areas. A cyclist has been critically injured following a crash involving a car in Auckland's Takanini this morning. It happened near the intersection of Walters and Grove Roads, with cordons in place and motorists asked to avoid the area. New SIG data shows advertised salaries grew 4.4% in the year to February. Jobsite says it's close to the fastest recorded growth in the data set. And Pope Francis has been hospitalised with a respiratory infection. The Vatican says he has breathing difficulties and will spend a few days in care, but denies the pontiff has COVID.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Jenny says annual random audits is part of business as usual, regardless of who the government of the day is. Auditing's pretty standard practice elsewhere, so why not politicians? I completely agree. And Joe Moyer, actually our political editor, texts as well. So just to clarify that investigation into Stuart Nash's communications, it does cover all his comms with all of his donors. It's 8:16.
Ask Tova.
It is your chance to ask me anything. You can get in touch, email asktova@todayfm.co.nz. And producer Jeremy sometimes puts on your voices, sometimes he just does them in his own voice, but he asks those questions.
Sometimes. It's very, very rare that I do. I want to do it all the time, but I'm not going to because I'm just so full of respect. Kerry McBride from Whanganui says
something.
Yeah, that's correct. Is what Stuart Nash did really so wrong? Someone big noting after a meeting is hardly a sackable offence. Oh, that's a voice.
That was where you did the voice. The point is, so cabinet is sacrosanct. It's where the government makes its decisions. They need to be able to have free and frank and private confidential conversations in that cabinet room, and because there's a process, right, to get to the end point before things are made public. And then we also get to see elements of that protest using things like the Official Information Act. We can get cabinet papers and advice that have been sent to ministers, so we can kind of eke out a bit of a picture. But those politicians need to be able to make those decisions in a confidential bubble. Stuart Nash broke that bubble, and not only did he break that bubble, he broke that bubble by sending those top secret details to donors, people who had given him money, who had a vested interest in that policy. So it is really bad. It's about as bad as it gets.
Imagine working for an organisation and like people start leaking out emails to the media. I wonder what that would feel like.
Ask Tova.
Imagine.
Grant Baker from Palmerston North says, can you explain ChatGPT for me? I'm a truck driver. Could it take my job?
I was worried, actually, Grant, that it could take my job. I don't know if it can take your job. It probably could take my job. ChatGPT is also what I've been calling it, but I'm told that it's actually ChatGPT. And as we discussed with our head of digital a wee while back, it's basically a chatbot, a computer program that allows you to have a human-like conversation with it. It's powered by large amounts of data and computing techniques to make predictions that then string words together in a meaningful way. They not only tap into a kind of vast amount of vocab and info. It also understands words in context and then helps them mimic speech patterns while dispatching an encyclopedic knowledge. I'm starting to sound like ChatGPT. But I wouldn't worry about it taking over a truck driver job, not anytime soon. We played that amazing clip earlier of someone using AI to then recreate a Kanye song. To recreate Kanye's voice. So we're getting into real Black Mirror territory, I think, with this stuff. It's 19 past eight.
Ask Tova.
Oh, we're still going. We got more.
I just thought we'd just do one more because this one made me quite sad. Richard Hillcock from Shannon says, Tova, I'm struggling to make ends meet every month.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I'm thinking of dropping my cat Lewis off to the SPCA. Would you possibly take him instead?
Oh, Richard, I'm really sorry to hear that. First of all, I think you should try and hold on to him if you can. Hold on to your cat, because the comfort that we get from our kitty cats is priceless. And I know it's tough, but perhaps there are some local organisations that might be able to help you and support you and help pay for cat food as well as, of course, your own food. Have a chat to the SPCA as well, see if they've got any options for you. I've already got one little stray adopted cat, Polly, living with me. She joined me on the couch yesterday, and case in point, I was feeling a bit glum, jumped up for the first time, bearing in mind that a couple of months ago she scratched me every time I went anywhere near her, and she snuggled all up and gave me some cuddles. So if you can, hold on to your kitty cat.
Tova.
On Today FM.
Okay, she is staunchly conservative. She is a massive deal. She's got more social media followers than the population of New Zealand across her various platforms. A Fox News host who rose to prominence during the Trump era, Tommy Lemon, is with us next.
This afternoon with Lloyd.
Do you know the answer to the Today FM $1,000 question? Win $1,000 twice a day, every single day, with Tova and Lloyd Burr live on Today FM.
There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, call 0508-NETSAFE 7 days a week. That's 0508-NETSAFE. Or visit netsafe.org.nz.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? Paydayadvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved, and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest, fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, paydayadvance.co.nz.
Bathroom moisture from shower steam. It's a problem in most homes. So eliminate steam with a Shower Dome shower top. With Shower Dome, you get a warmer, drier bathroom and a lifetime guarantee. That'll give you the warm fuzzies. Showerdome.co.nz.
It's time to cut and run. This time I'm really done.
Is your team driving today? Restricted drivers are more at risk of crashing when driving with friends. There's a reason for the restrictions. Home by 10 p.m. No passengers.
TradeDepot.co.nz.
Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices.
TradeDepot.co.nz.
Everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door.
TradeDepot.co.nz.
battery is letting you down.
Is your vehicle sounding slower to start? Get it tested at your local Battery Town workshop now. For all car, truck, motorcycle or motorhome batteries before you get stuck. With over 90 stores nationwide, there's one near you. Call 0800 566 667.
There's only one place to go and that's Battery Town.
The phone call politicians always answer.
Tova, unwinding the spin and finding the facts.
With Generate.
Talk to the experts about maximising your KiwiSaver account.
Today FM.
Nashville police are refusing to release the manifesto written by the Covenant School shooter, which killed six people, including three children. They've revealed that the shooter legally bought seven firearms from local stores despite being under medical supervision for a, quote, emotional disorder. The tragedy is once again reigniting calls for stricter gun control in the United States, which, as ever, faces fierce opposition from Republicans and conservatives, like our next guest. Tommy Lehrin is the host of Tommy Lehrin is Fearless. She is also a commentator for Fox News and has more social media followers than the population of our entire country. I'm thrilled to welcome her to Today FM. Good morning, Tommy.
Well, hello there. You know, it's great to talk to you. And it's not often that Nashville, Tennessee gets international attention. So I wish it was under better circumstances. But we appreciate you guys shining a light on the tragedy that happened here earlier this week. And it's important for us to have a discussion about it.
Indeed. And I've had the pleasure of visiting once in the past. And I love Nashville. And it's your home as well. So, Tommy, I'd like to extend our condolences for what your community is going through there.
Well, we really appreciate that. And, you know, it is a beautiful, vibrant city. We're going to stick together. We're going to come through this. But the way that the national and even international media is covering what happened here, you know, it's honestly, it's really disheartening for a lot of us here in Nashville.
Okay, we'll talk about that shortly, but I would like to talk about gun control, because every time there is one of these mass shootings in the United States, this is the topic that comes up. Surely now is the time for tougher gun control, red flag laws at least, that might have prevented the sale of those guns to the shooter.
So I'm a big Second Amendment supporter, and you know, here in the South, we really are very proud of our gun rights and our freedom. So I will say this. There is a discussion that needs to be had about mental health in this country and preventing those that do have mental health issues from acquiring firearms. I think we can all agree on that. How we get to that is going to be somewhat of a debate. But I will also tell you this, because I talk to a lot of people that live outside of the United States and they don't understand our gun culture here in the U.S. But I'll tell you this. If these people that go in to slaughter young children cared about laws, they wouldn't be doing what they did in the first place. So there's a discussion to be had about who should be able to acquire a firearm, especially when there's mental illness that's present. But to me, the solution, because there's so many guns in circulation in the United States, you're not going to get rid of them all. You're not going to restrict them all, especially for law-abiding Americans. You're not going to prevent freaks and psychos from getting their hands on them, I'll tell you that.
Yes, but, shouldn't we try? Because since Columbine, there have been 376 school shootings, 348,000 students, Tommy, have experienced gun violence. Parents are scared to send their kids to school.
And there's no doubt we need to have a conversation about that. But I will also say this, gun ownership in the last 30 plus years in the United States has not really fluctuated much. Same amount of gun owners statistically, it's very close, right? But what we have seen in the last 30 years, as you referenced, is an uptick in these school shootings and in these mass shootings. That's why we have to address what has changed in the last 30 years. And it's mental health that has changed in the last 30 years. And I know we're going to talk about the shooter herself and the things that she was battling there mentally and talking about the fact that she was trans. I'm sure we're going to get into that. But I will tell you this, law-abiding Americans, we want to be able to protect and defend ourselves against people who are lawless, reckless, and deranged. And we do that in the United States by owning our own firearms.
Yeah, except,
so there's a discussion to be had.
I will contest you. Sorry to interrupt. I will contest you because there are more guns than the U.S. So U.S. gun sales reached a record 23 million in 2020. That's a 65% increase from 2019. So they have gone up. And then I think if you compare the United States to the U.K., since the Dunblane school shooting there in 1996, when they tightened their gun laws, there have been seven mass shootings in the U.K. You've had more than 600. You have more than 600 a year. The numbers tell a different story.
Yeah, so I hear this example a lot. You know, I discussed this yesterday with Piers Morgan, somebody else who had the same example. I'll tell you this, though. The United States and the UK are very different, and we can't compare the two apples to apples because they're not, right? We have guns in this country. You're not going to eradicate guns in this country. You're not. Even if you go door to door and try to take people's guns, you're not going to get rid of guns in this country. So we have them embedded into our culture, into our Constitution. Now, the question is, do we prevent those that are mentally ill from obtaining them? Yeah, we certainly do. But there are other facets to address here besides confiscating guns from law-abiding Americans. You take guns from law-abiding Americans, and then it's the law-abiding Americans that are essentially neutered because of freaks and psychos who want to go and cause death and destruction. Okay. So looking at the gun umbrage, and an object,
I recognize that we are talking about murderous individuals. I do take slight umbrage with freaks and psychos, because especially when we're talking about mental illness. I wonder what your view is, Tommy, on, so after a terror attack here in New Zealand, which killed 51 people, we banned military-style semi-automatics. We did it within a week. What did you make of our swift action?
Well, again, New Zealand is much different than the United States. It's very hard to have this discussion when you have a country that's landscape is completely different than our own. And you mentioned the uptick in purchasing firearms in 2020. And the reason for that is because of the lawlessness in America in general. So people feel the need to protect and defend themselves and their families and their homes for a very simple reason, that we have lawlessness that's taking over our country. And we have a careless disregard for human life. And that is something that needs to be addressed. It needs to be addressed culturally. It doesn't need to be addressed by taking away the rights and freedoms of law-abiding, decent people. So that's where you and I are never going to see eye to eye on this. Mm-hmm. I'm a proud Second Amendment advocate, and I would hope that the way that we protect our politicians, our jewelry stores, our banks with trained individuals with firearms, I would hope we have those same protections for our schools. Now, that's a conversation that should be had.
The majority of your tweets, and you've been kind of angling to talk about it this morning, they've focused on the fact that the shooter was trans. But surely, Tommy, what actually matters here and what should be addressed is how someone was able to access weapons while being treated for an emotional disorder. Surely that should be the focus.
Oh, absolutely. So we should acknowledge the fact that this widespread now and encouraged gender dysmorphia is, in fact, a part of a mental illness that needs to be addressed in this country. And unfortunately, it's being pushed on children younger and younger and younger. So we do need to have a conversation about mental health. We do need to know if the shooter was on testosterone or any other hormone-altering medications that could have contributed to their mindset in this. Okay. That is a discussion that certainly needs to be had.
I don't know if we can... Yeah, I think this is probably another thing, Tommy, that you and I are not going to see eye to eye on. I wouldn't describe it as gender dysmorphia. Can I just ask you, though, before you go, Trump, are you going to be supporting him or DeSantis for 2024?
Listen, I'm supporting anybody but Joe Biden. But I will say this. I think that if we're looking realistically at 2024 as conservatives and Republicans, this is an election that we cannot afford to lose. So I believe that our best bet to get into the White House is somebody who has gained widespread popularity in Florida and throughout the nation. And I do believe that that person that's going to take us across the finish line is Ron DeSantis. Now, I'm a Trump supporter. Yeah. I love Donald Trump. I love what he did for our country. But I think that it's time for a new era of leadership, somebody who also puts America first. And I think that person is going to be Ron DeSantis for our Republican Party.
Wowee. That's you heard it there, folks. And your voice carries a lot of weight on these things. Fascinating speaking with you. And good as well that, you know, we can have conversations with people we don't necessarily agree with. And Tommy and I both recognize that. But it's just an absolute pleasure having you on the program this morning. Tommy Lehren, thank you.
Thank you for having me. And I will say, I always appreciate the discussion and the dialogue. We need to have more of it in this country and around the world. I think we would be a lot better for it. So thank you for having me.
Thank you very much. Tommy Lehren there, conservative. Well, she's kind of commentator, influencer, broadcaster. She's everywhere. If you're on social media, she's everywhere. I wanted to use that Oscar-winning film title, Jeremy, but I've completely forgotten what it was. Everything, Everywhere, All at Once. Tommy Lehren, there you go. Let me know your thoughts on that. A few things that we traverse there. I always appreciate having a rational debate, even if I completely disagree with someone, a rational debate about some of those big issues. Tommy Lehren, more social media followers than the population of New Zealand. It's 8:30.
Happening now.
A belief the 20-year mystery of the disappearance of Waikato mother Sarah Neas may soon be solved, despite partner Mark Pakenham refusing to say where he buried her body. Private investigator Bruce Curry says he's confident of cracking the case. Police are being given the power to bring down drones if they're being flown in a dangerous manner. It's been announced as part of a shake-up to aviation rules. Other changes include random drug testing for workers in safety-sensitive areas. A plea for the government not to follow through with proposed changes to Therapeutic Products Bill, which would see the importation of prescription meds by post banned. One lung cancer patient says she'd save thousands of dollars a month by flying overseas to purchase the life-saving drugs. A deep low east of the north directs a strong southerly flow over central New Zealand. The southerly flow gradually eases today as a ridge builds over the country, and then a trough spreads from the west on Saturday.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
Let's bring a little balance in here on the issue of US gun reforms off the back of that Nashville shooting at the Covenant School earlier this week. Immediately afterwards, we spoke with Nashville Councilwoman Angie Henderson, and she was at the scene of the attack. We talked about gun reform with her. Take a listen.
I don't want our community, our state, our country to become inured to this level of violence. When a parent sends their child off to school in the morning to their church-affiliated school right down the street from them in their community, they would never think that there would be a mass shooting. But I do feel in some regard it is in the back of parents' minds. And so it just sort of is a existential heightened background fear that I worry sometimes we're just becoming used to.
And I am definitely more on the side of Councilwoman Angie Henderson there. 19 names have been revealed so far, people. Coming up next, we're revealing number 81 on Today FM's Greatest Kiwi of All Time.
What does Duncan think? Duncan Garner Today, unpacking all the day's stories. Coming up after the 9am news on Today FM.
There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, 08 NetSafe or visit netsafe.org.nz.
Man needs meat. You office workers need meat. It gives you strength to laugh at your boss's inappropriate jokes, the energy for idle chit-chat at the coffee machine. And you know you can't spell meetings without meat, right? Get some Jack Link's beef jerky into your drawers, and I mean the ones under your desk. You don't need HR asking awkward questions again, do you? Jack Link's, feed your wild side.
Beyond Greatness is just around the corner. Tickets for the FIFA Women's World Cup 2023 will be available online from April 11th. Don't miss out on world-class football in action. Register your interest now at fifa.com/tickets.
Destroying the incompetent every morning.
Fierce and fearless. There's only one Tova. With Generate. Switch to an award-winning KiwiSaver provider today.
On Today FM.
Hi Tova and team. Thanks for the Heart of Glass. After 7am, the Blondie hit. That song is 45 years old this year, says Tony. Debbie Harry was my first crush. Oh my gosh, me too. And the band is headlining Glastonbury this year, if only to be there. I wish I was there as well. I love her so much. Were you equally grateful for the AC/DC that we played coming out of 8 o'clock as well? Can you mix that up, DJ? Wow, he can. Thank you, Jeremy, for that. It's time now for the greatest Kiwi of all time. The countdown has been continuing. We're up to number 81. And I think who did Rachel have this morning? It was Peter Gordon, the chef. Do you know, I did some maths, though. Of the, I can't remember how many have been announced so far, only 4 women, which worked out to be about 22% so far in the lower tiers of the greatest Kiwi of all time. So I'm optimistic.
They'll be in the top 10.
It's going to be a heavy loaded Chicky Babe Fest up there in the top 10, eh, Carly? That's what I'm holding out hope
Chicky
for.
Chicky Babe Fest.
Chicky Babe Fest.
Love it.
All right, greatest Kiwi of all time, number 81. And after that, listen carefully as well to this, remember, because afterwards I'll ask you a question which relates to the announcement, and you can go in the... No, you don't get go in the draw. You win a $50 Razine voucher if you get the answer right and first. All right, Jeremy, take it away.
Today FM's greatest Kiwi of all time.
81 on our greatest Kiwi countdown. Down 5, it's Tarangi Hiroa. Yeah.
The man with two names, Peter Henry Buck, a.k.a. Tarangi Hiroa. Born in Taranaki in 1877, Peter, for most of his life, believed that Ngārongo Kitua was his mum. She had married Peter's father, William Buck, at Urunui in the early 1870s. But their marriage was childless, and in accordance with Māori custom, a relative, Rina, came into the household to provide William with a child, so he was nurtured by Ngārongo. Peter, by then Tarangi Hiroa, was the first Māori medical graduate from a New Zealand university. Let's fast forward to 1949, where Sir Tarangi Hiroa attended a civic reception in Dunedin, where 40 years prior he had attended medical school. Fast forward to 1949, where Sir Tarangi Hiroa attended a civic reception in Dunedin.
I know that Dunedin is one of the best cities in New Zealand. I know it, not from hearsay, but for experience of having lived here for over 6 years. And anything that anybody can say about Dunedin and its people has my very sincere support.
Let's fast forward again to 2013. After permission from Tarangi Hiroa's iwi and surviving family members, Otago University named its newest residential college, formerly known as Living Space, as Tarangi Hiroa College in honour of its first Māori graduate. Tarangi Hiroa, Sir Peter Buck, graduated in 1904 in medicine and later received an MD in 1910, his doctoral thesis being Medicine Amongst the Māori in Ancient and Modern Times. Tarangi Hiroa is reverently remembered as a great son of Taranaki and a leader and doctor among his people, a man who used his medical training to stem the tide of profound and serious health problems that almost wiped out the Māori population in the first part of the 20th century. Tarangi Hiroa, Sir Peter Buck, our first Māori medical graduate from a New Zealand university and one of Today FM's greatest Kiwis of all time.
Today FM's greatest Kiwi of all time. Thanks to Razine, helping Kiwis decorate with New Zealand-made paint since 1946.
Awesome. I can definitely get behind... Oh! Thanks, Jeremy. That gave me a fright. Sir Tarangi Hiroa, also known as Sir Peter Henry Buck. And the question, if you want to win a $50 Razine voucher, the first person to text in to 3920 and correctly answer this question... Which university named its residential college after Tarangi Hiroa? Flick me a text and we'll be back shortly with the winner.
Happening now.
A belief the 20-year mystery of the disappearance of Waikato mother Sarah Neith might soon be solved, despite partner Mark Pakenham refusing to say where he buried her body. Private investigator Bruce Curry says he's confident of cracking the case. Police are being given the power to bring down drones if they're being flown in a dangerous manner. It's been announced as part of a shake-up to aviation rules. Other changes include random drug testing for workers in safety-sensitive areas. And a plea for the government not to follow through with proposed changes to Therapeutic Products Bill, which would see the importation of prescription meds by post banned. One lung cancer patient says she'd save thousands of dollars a month by flying overseas to purchase life-saving drugs. A deep low east of the north directs a strong southerly flow over central New Zealand. The southerly flow gradually eases today as a ridge builds over the country and then a trough spreads from the west on Saturday.
News every 12 minutes at breakfast.
And the latest in breaking news as it happens on Today FM.
All right, it is now 16 or quarter to 9 and it is time to bring in our senior business correspondent, Rebecca Stevenson. Morena, Rebecca, we talked about Alibaba earlier and the company actually held a business forum in Auckland this week. What was that like?
Yeah, it was fantastic. You know, it was the first event that Alibaba has hosted, I think, since we've had COVID. You know, it used to do these quite regularly. You know, we know China is just massive for New Zealand and especially for exporters. It is our largest export partner. You know, and last year, I think New Zealand businesses exported more than $20 billion worth of goods to mainland China. So it was great to see Alibaba back here. One of the really funny things was they just provided great insights into Chinese consumers. And one of my favorite moments was hearing how they described consumer segments on Tmall Global. And this is how they were splitting them up. There were rookie white collars, the wealthy middle class, super moms, the small town mature crowd, urban gray hairs, which a lot of us ended up taking personally. And there was also the urban blue collars or just Gen Z. So they were providing lots of information about who are the rising consumer segments that New Zealand businesses should be targeting on Tmall Global. But also it was a really a one-stop shop for getting your product to China through Alibaba. You know, they had booths set up to help offer businesses to tap into their massive platform, you know, step by step. Data and analytics specialists did presentations. They talked about how to do payments, warehousing your products in China, you know, you name it. They were going to talk you through it. We had the dairy giant Fonterra was there giving a presentation about its businesses here and in China, including how it's using influencers to promote its products through live streams on Tmall. And overall, it's just always really impressive and inspiring when Alibaba is in town. It is incredibly slick. It runs wonderful events. And also, it just draws these New Zealand business owners from all over who are just really excited to take their products to China and to the world. So it was just a really nice sign, I think, that some of these things are getting back to normal in terms of doing business around the world. Also, post this big COVID years that we've had.
There's an enormous period of transformation for everybody, really. Thank you so much, Rebecca, always for your wisdom and your commentary. That is our business correspondent, our senior business correspondent, Rebecca Stevenson. We'll catch you again tomorrow at 20 to 7. And coming up, Debate Club. We are too hard on politicians. Duncan Garner is going to have to somehow argue that we are.
Looking for a safe place to borrow from? Paydayadvance.co.nz can help. We'll work hard to get you approved and we're committed to responsible lending. So credit criteria, interest fees and T's and C's apply. When the bus won't help, paydayadvance.co.nz.
There is a service to help people experiencing online bullying, online abuse and online harassment. To find out how NetSafe can help, call 0508 NetSafe 7 days a week. That's 0508 NetSafe. Or visit netsafe.org.nz.
It's time to cut and run. This time I'm really done.
Is your team driving today? Restricted drivers are more at risk of crashing when driving with friends. There's a reason for the restrictions. Home by 10 p.m. No passengers.
TradeDepot.co.nz. Now you can shop online for an incredible selection of beautiful kitchens, bathrooms and appliances without even leaving the house. Always high spec, always low prices. TradeDepot.co.nz. Everything from bathroom tapware to kitchen ovens. Just click to fill your cart with more and they'll deliver straight to your door. TradeDepot.co.nz.
Bathroom moisture from shower steam. It's a problem in most homes. So eliminate steam with a Shower Dome shower top. With Shower Dome, you get a warmer, drier bathroom and a lifetime guarantee. That'll give you the warm fuzzies. Showerdome.co.nz.
Man needs meat. You office workers need meat. It gives you strength to laugh at your boss's inappropriate jokes. The energy for idle chit-chat at the coffee machine. And you know you can't spell meetings without meat, right? Get some Jack Link's beef jerky into your drawers. And I mean the ones under your desk. You don't need HR asking awkward questions again, do you? Jack Link's. Feed your wild side.
Finally,
Savings can help you get more done this Easter for a lot less. Give your rooms a brand new look with a splash of colour. Get the job done right with a 230mm roller, just $16.45. Brighten up your walls with Easy Coat 4-lead interior paint, just $89.78. And paint with precision using a Monarch 63mm paintbrush, just $8.98. Will you find a competitor's lower price on the same stocked item available for same day delivery or collection? We'll beat it by 15%. Conditions apply. See website for details. Lowest prices are just the beginning.
Open your ears to open your mind.
The people changing the world are on Tova.
With Generate.
Awarded a Consumer New Zealand People's Choice Award for KiwiSaver.
On Today FM.
You're listening to Today FM thanks to Generate KiwiSaver, award-winning New Zealand-owned KiwiSaver specialists.
Tova's Debate Club.
I've got Carly Flynn and Duncan Garner in here with me for our usual debate club segment, and one that was close to our hearts this morning, that we are too hard on politicians. But we have just been chatting in the break as a team, and we have decided to break away from our normal programming here because
there's a bit going on in the background.
Feel like we haven't been entirely upfront with our listeners. Last week, you'll have heard us reference the fact that Dallas Gurney, who is our head of news and the architect of Today FM and our number one champion and the guy that so many of us came here to work for, he resigned. It followed the resignation of our CEO, Cam Wallace. And since then, we haven't been able to get the same level of assurance from the board, from our acting CEO, about what the future of Today FM looks like. And bearing in mind that we came into this organisation with this promise of a long-term strategy, we were going to go for at least 5 years, and that's when we were going to start seeing the results.
They had our back for a
they
number
had our back
of years.
From the CEO to the executive to the board. This is what we were told. And when I met with the acting chief executive last week, I could not get those same assurances. Our team has not been able to get those same assurances. We don't know. And I'm not catastrophizing here. I'm still optimistic and I'm hoping for the best for Today FM because we believe in what we do and we do a damn good thing. But we just want to be honest with you and let you know that it's been a tough time for us here. It's been something we've been talking about a lot, and we feel like it's unfair not to have involved you, our Today FM community.
And we don't know what's going on.
No, but I think it's fair to say, and you know, I've been around this business for a while, and I think it's fair to say that we're more exposed now. We've lost
our number one.
Well, Cam Wallace and Dallas is signalling that he's going to leave. Because Dallas is a brilliant radio man. And
what he's created here, I'm so proud of.
I think you're right, Toby. I think there is something going on, and I think we're exposed. We don't have a line of defence anymore, if you know what I mean. The company's bleeding cash. A number of people have come up to me and just in recent days and said, we're bleeding cash.
You guys, and this is an industry-wide problem. We should recognise that. You know, it's tough for media. Going into a recession any time, the first thing that businesses look to cut is the advertising.
Sky TV this week, 170 jobs.
And cutting coffee beans and the odd person that doesn't cut it. If you need to take millions out of an organisation, then stations start to go into, you know, red lights.
And we are the newest station.
We were last on board, yeah.
But we are also future-proofing for Media Works because
this
news and talk is strong. But as Duncan says, we're scared. We're optimistic and we've got to hold out hope here, but we're scared. And we want to be honest with you because we don't know what's going to happen. And you've been along with us for this entire journey. And
so you've had a meeting this morning, have you?
I've been called to a meeting this morning.
Okay, so, and I'm on air in from 9. I think people need to call us.
Yeah. We've been on air for a year.
Yeah, we have loved it, and we will continue to be here for you as long as we can be here for you. I think that, you know, the station set out to provide hope and to provide a place for alternative conversations to be and opinions to be heard, and I think we've done that, and I would be absolutely gutted if we didn't get to continue this because Duncan, your show is absolutely phenomenal. The platform that you provide for listeners.
People are amazing.
People are amazing, and I feel like we have the support here.
Yeah,
but we don't have the cash.
Yeah, and I think, but we will, you know, keep us going. And I'm sure that they will. I mean, wise heads have got to prevail here because what we do is great. What we do for you, and you guys are telling us, look at all these texts coming in. I love you guys at Today FM. I hope you survive. You're the best in the biz. I love you guys. Lots of love to you. All this love coming in from you guys.
Do you know what I think our difference is? because we're authentic and we get to be ourselves. I mean, day in, day out.
We put a Give a Little page up this morning.
Yeah,
I mean, a couple.
We do it for others.
How much to the bosses? You're going to go in there at 9 o'clock this morning, Tova. Once you're out of there, come straight to me. Come straight into the studio live.
Yeah, I will do.
Because if it's all over, then it's all over. And so let's shout from the rooftops to our people, to our community. Can we raise money? Do we need, I mean, this happened to Campbell Live back in the day when they said you're for the chop, and Joel went out there and the audience just rallied, you know.
Sunrise walked out of the building at 9 a.m. didn't get to come back.
Did get to come back in? No, I do recall that sort of thing. So yeah, it's up to our audience, I suppose.
We've got this. We're strong. Yep. Our newsroom is strong.
Do I have to do a show at 9? I suppose I do.
Yes, and tomorrow, and the next day, and the next day, and the next day, because we will keep fighting for what we believe in here at Today FM. We'll keep fighting for our whānau, for our newsroom, for our teams.
But the people who own companies are brutal. You know, they need to make cuts, they'll make cuts.
And this is something we're talking about every morning when we come in. What's it going to be? What's going to happen? Not able to get those assurances.
Well, the board's here again. They've come back.
What are they looking at? Are we the one?
It's unsettling, isn't it?
And
I bet many people, maybe that's what you talk about this morning, Duncan. I bet there are many people out there that are worried about their jobs right now.
I tell you why we're engineering this recession. I tell you what's important. There was a man who emailed me yesterday. His son was almost abducted. He was the only one on the bus. Someone followed him with a black plastic bag and a knife in his pocket, and he screamed and ran away and hid behind the beehives in his rural property. This is in the Kaimai Ranges. That father got hold of me last night. I emailed him back at length overnight, didn't sleep, rang this morning, first thing this morning, have spoken to him. He's coming on the program this morning.
Wow.
There's a real concern around the Kaimai Ranges that this man is still on the loose. Police are heavily involved. Their reaction was brilliant and swift, and that's why I give a stuff about why I'm doing broadcasting this morning.
Yeah.
You know?
And every day, until they pull me out of here. And we're just like reflecting as well. And we had our 1 year anniversary just last week, and we have been reflected on the incredible year that we've had and the stories that we've been able to tell and the change that we have been able to affect here at Today FM.
And the community that we've built.
And that's why we're talking to you now.
If they get rid of it, I'm not sure they understand. It's a really significant story. It's a big story. There's a lot of names and faces would go, and you know, I'm starting to shake now with the thought of this and having to do a show. And you know, this is
we'll stay with you. Why don't we stay with you?
You're coming back in anyway.
I'm also still optimistic, and we have to be, because they will see sense. You know, people have to see sense, and we are. You know, as far as
we're
I know, the books
station.
Are pretty good for us.
Yeah.
And I've been told that you know, the numbers, they tell the story, and so hopefully that is the story.
Well,
money matters,
sponsors,
we're doing well.
There's revenue that comes to the station.
And there's you, our listeners. And I have every intention of staying here and staying on air, but we really felt like it was important for us to disclose what's been going on here.
Because it's a bit discombobulating.
It's been a tough time.
Yeah.
And we've put on a brave face, and we've been trying to be professional, and we've come in here every day, and we're still enjoying it now.
I have just received a text.
Mm-hmm. Can you share?
From the CEO, from the interim CEO, could we have a catch-up when you get off here this morning, please? Just pop into my office.
Right.
So I've just received the text as well.
Okay, so that's a couple of us now who have been summoned to the chief executive's office, the acting chief executive, and when I asked her last week for an assurance about...
Your job? Our station?
Our station, and I couldn't get anything.
That's pretty unsettling text message to get 3 minutes before you're going on air, isn't it?
Yeah.
On your show.
Well, I'm hoping she's calling us in to tell us that we are going to get
news.
That assurance.
Yeah, we think you're doing really well and we want to extend your contracts.
In no reality that I live in do we go from having 100% support of everybody for a long-term plan to lights out. So I can't believe that anyone would be so short-sighted and so brutal and so ruthless. But
when we all set up,
it'll play out badly. Trust me, we've seen this before. It'll play out badly.
We've all experienced it before.
Media Works will be buying quite a fight, I think, with certain sections of society with this.
Sad news. Just these are the texts flooding in. Sad news. Just discovered the station. Kia kaha. You guys will be okay. Our dials will follow you wherever you go.
Thank you.
You guys are my number one go-to radio station. I won't listen to anything else now. I'm gutted to hear the conversation. And so people are just flooding in and supporting us, and we're grateful for that. And that's why we wanted to tell you this morning. We don't know. We don't know anything. That's part of the problem.
But
so we've gone off
instinct.
Piste today.
We've got gut instinct.
Yeah, we've gone off piste. We've broken from regular programs. programming. We're hoping that we're not going to be dragged out of here by security guards because we're supposed to be doing Debate Club right now. But we thought it was important to share with you what's been going on for us behind the scenes here. So whatever the decision is, hopefully a good one. No one is going to be blindsided by it in our Today FM community. We love you guys. We love our newsroom. I love you too. Yeah, thank you for
we love
what
we get to do.
Here.
It's always such a privilege to get to talk to New Zealanders and to share stories of cool Kiwis.